Order! Order! You are an incorrigible delinquent at times. Behave yourself, man!
What would you pick as the pivotal moment when you realised that, and I appreciate a significant number of people listening to this programme still haven't realised, but I will continue to do my best to help the pennies to drop. What was the pivotal moment when you realised that they didn't have a Scooby-Doo, what it was that they were supposed to do next? Whether you look at the key players, the sort of David Davises and Liam Foxes of this world, and realised that they genuinely, that not just had a poor grasp of the facts, but were abjectly ignorant of the most simple concepts. I'd probably go back to May of 2016 when David Davis tweeted his visions of what post-Brexit trade negotiations would look like without realising that almost every single thing he said he was going to do would be illegal under EU law. And when you're talking about ordinary punters, the poor souls who've been duped and conned on an epic scale, I think I know when the penny dropped for me. They can't admit it to themselves yet. The point at which they realised they'd been conned was when they started saying that the it doesn't matter what happens, the fact that Ramonas are so upset makes it all worthwhile. And that is quite an incredible psychological condition to be in, isn't it? I there's probably a fancy phrase for it. The idea that you have done something awful that's going to really, really hurt you, but you're okay with it because the people who are pointing out how awful it is and how much it's going to hurt you are really upset on your behalf. Imagine the kind of contortions and the mental gymnastics you'd have to undertake in order to arrive in a place like that. And how have so many people arrived in a place like that? Well, I think Jacob Rees-Mogg gave a little hint unwittingly in that clip that you just heard during the news when he talked about believing. Even now, they're talking about believing. You don't believe in things that are invisible and ill-defined. Now, you may, of course, be a religious person, but I don't think anyone would argue that the country should follow a path that is, at the very, very least, beset with problems and disadvantage because of somebody else's beliefs. And I'd like to think we'd got that kind of attitude out of our systems in this country in Tudor times. Believe. Theresa May doesn't believe. Believe what, mate? Doesn't believe what? She doesn't believe that it will be good. No, well, nobody who's examined all of the evidence believes that we're going to end off better off than we are now. Nobody believes that. Nobody believes that based on evidence. So what Jacob Rees-Mogg really said this morning, very simple, and he said it a few times in the past, but never quite so explicitly. What he really said this morning was, Theresa May has paid too much attention to the evidence. Theresa May has paid too much attention to the head of Jaguar Land Rover. He is genuinely trying to tell you that you should listen to him. He knows more about running Jaguar Land Rover than the bloke who runs Jaguar Land Rover. He knows more about what will happen to the port of Dover than the bloke who runs the port of Dover. He knows more about the international supply chains of Airbus and Siemens than the men and women who run the international supply chains of Airbus and Siemens. And I don't know if this counts as a moment of clarity for me, but it's lovely to see it actually coalesce. It's lovely to see it coagulate, come together in such an irresistible way, because the divide now, thanks to David Davis's resignation, is completely clear. The divide now is very simply between people who don't care how much worse off we are, who don't care anymore, because they somehow believe in something that the rest of us can't see. So, in the interest of full disclosure and balance, what is it that Jacob Rees-Mogg believes in? 0345 6060 973, that Theresa May doesn't. Just put it into a sentence for me, if you can. Jacob Rees-Mogg believes in it, and he criticises and castigates the Prime Minister for not believing in it. Believing in what? Second question today, what's David Davis been doing for the last 2 years? Has anyone seen him around, like in IKEA or something like that? Has he got a kit car? Has he been building one of those kind of ersatz sports cars in his garage for the last 2 years? Well, what has he actually been doing? And does he now get sanctioned under the terms of universal credit? Does he get sanctioned for having spent 2 years, not even looking for a job? 4 hours of negotiations he's spent. By the time this show finishes, we will have spent three quarters of the time together in a single morning that David Davis has spent negotiating with Michel Barnier in 2 years. So, question number one, what is it that Jacob Rees-Mogg believes in? Can you just put it into words for me? 0345 60 60 973. Question number two. What has David Davis been doing for the last 2 years? The Secretary of State for leaving the European Union has had 2 years to explain to the country how and why leaving the European Union is going to be good. And at the final hurdle, when the government actually agrees, when the cabinet actually agrees on a plan for now, he walks away. He walks away. Well, I mean, what's a genuine question? It sounds slightly facetious. It is perhaps a little mischievous. But what has he been doing for the last 2 years? What have we paid him for? That's what I really, really would like to know. What have we actually paid him for? So what does Jacob Rees-Mogg believe in that Theresa May doesn't? In your own words, and you can come at it from whatever angle you want, what has David Davis been paid for as a Secretary of State, as a minister, for the last 2 years? I think it's one of those days, and we haven't had one like this for a while, I think it's one of those days where you can ring in with anything you want to be, as long as it's about the developing story, the unfolding shenanigans that is Brexit. You don't have to phone in specifically to answer my questions. You can even ring in with questions of your own, actually. And I tell you what, if you get them on the board, they'll be put to some of the prominent Brexiters who are appearing on the radio station in the course of the day. Unlikely they're going to appear here, because those are the questions I'd ask. What have you done for the last 2 years, David Davis? And Mr. Rees-Mogg, what is it you believe in? Can you just explain it to people? Let's not even imagine that they're atheists. What is the God of Brexit that you can see and most sensible people can't? And if you're a follower of Rees-Mogg, if you're one of these poor people who is still labouring under the illusion that he's anything other than pantomime toff with an utterly cultivated and entirely contrived demeanour designed to appeal to the doff-capped, hug-forelock, deferential streak of Britain that none of us knew was as big as it is. If you're a fan of the fella, what is it that you believe in that Theresa May doesn't? Because all I've got now is, I don't care how awful it is, we have to get out. And then when you say, why do we have to get out, you get a long catalogue, and it hasn't changed for 2 years, the needle hasn't budged. You get a long catalogue of nonsense and exaggeration. Don't you? All this stuff about... look at power. The plan put together this weekend by the cabinet, very simply, as I understand it, has been castigated by hardcore Brextremists because it involves surrendering powers to Brussels that they've spent 40 years telling us we didn't have. Just think about that for a moment. I've got nuggets galore to share with you today. I'll probably run out of time or forget to get them all out there. So there's the first observation of the day. 40 years they've spent telling us that we don't have the power, and now they're complaining about this plan because it would involve surrendering the power that they've told us for 40 years we never had to Brussels, which is quite strange, isn't it? And again, if you're a believer, how do you process that absolutely incontrovertible evidence that the people you're following are frauds? Frauds and charlatans, every single one of them, some consciously, some unconsciously, some knowing now that they have either fallen in a hole or disseminated deceit, or still, and that's why that word belief is so important, still able to silence all of the voices of logic and reason, all of the evidence, all of the numbers, the statistics, all of the expert testimony from the people who actually run the businesses that are going to be affected. That's an astonishing level of faith-based delusion, isn't it, when you think about it?
The trouble is that both sides in my party, the Conservative Party, each has a fatal weakness. The fatal weakness of the hardline Brexiteers is that there is no majority in the Conservative Party, in the Labour Party, in Parliament or in the country for a hard Brexit. The weakness of the Remainers, or the former Remainers, is that a Brexit in name only, where we're rule takers but not rule makers, cannot by any stretch of the imagination be better than just staying in the European Union. Yeah. Well, so both sides are fatally weak.
But that's the trouble with Brexit, isn't it?
Yes.
That if we are going to do it, and we can argue that we have a democratic responsibility to do it, we're going to end up with this awful thing that pleases nobody but gets a consensus and makes us worse off than we are currently. That's precisely the problem with Brexit, right there. Mm.
It is a terrible thing that we have consensus on this panel, which is not what you want, Evan.
No, I think it's really, really... But I think that is a very interesting place for parliamentary democracy to be.
I mean, I still... The Conservative Party has been written off a couple of times. You can go back to, as Jacob Rees-Mogg did, to the Corn Laws. And yes, the party was out of power for a couple of generations then. I can remember thinking, people analysing the major government and saying, well, the Tories will never win again after 1997. Well, they did in 2010. So nothing is forever.
Somebody's got to win this one, or I think the Conservative Party could destroy itself.
It is what
we, the Conservatives, are doing at the moment, and it cannot carry on like this, and the Conservative Party could destroy itself. Somebody has got to crack the whip.
And then the party becomes party of that.
And someone has to lose. My problem with the hardliners, the crazies on Europe, is that
they're not crazies. They just happen to believe in something very much.
It's not a political belief. It's a faith-based thing. And you see something go funny in their eyes when you start talking about Europe. And there is no arguing with these people. They are a minority of the Conservative Party, and they're bringing all of us down, including the country.
And I'm afraid
what would the equivalent be? The equivalent would be kind of being in a cult and believing that the world was going to end on July the 15th, and then waking up on July the 16th and thinking, somehow persuading yourself that you're still right. 03456060973 is the number to call. I don't think I can deal with the absolute lunatic fringe of the chomping unicornists, because you must just now be furious. You must be so cross with yourself, and until you can admit that you're cross with yourself, you're going to pretend that you're really cross with me. You know, the narrative of oh, it's all Remainers' fault, that's fallen out of the window today as well. So there you go, let's write these down. So number one, 40 years telling us that we didn't have any powers and now complaining that the Brexit plan involves giving up the powers they've spent 40 years telling us we never had. Number two, And I mean, this is a really funny one. It's a relatively recent development. Everything would be great if you would just get behind it. Everything would be great if people like you would just get behind it. It's a bit like believing. That's the difference between getting behind it and believing in it. We'll jot that down as well. But what's changed then? Why isn't everybody saying to David Davis, everything would have been fine if you could have just got behind it, if you could have just believed? Everything would be fine if you just believed. So this ludicrous narrative, possibly the most patronising element of the recent weeks of the Brexit debate, the idea that when it all goes up the swanny, as it inevitably will, as arguably it already has, it will somehow be the fault of the people who described the inevitability of it all going up the swanny. That again is another moment where people should have gone, yeah, that's a little bit odd. That's like blaming a fire alarm for fires. The alarm went off. Yeah, that's why the house burnt down. If you just got behind the idea that there was no fire, if that alarm had never gone off, there would have been no fire. And this is where you've allowed yourself to be driven to by people like Jacob Rees-Mogg. You're anti-fire alarms because you think they cause fires. You think that disasters are caused by the people who predict disasters, not by the people who drive the bus towards the disaster. So we've got powers that they've spent 40 years telling us we didn't have. They're now complaining we'll have to surrender to Brussels. You've got the idea that the plan would work if only people would get behind it, being utterly, utterly dismantled by the fact that the Secretary of State for leaving the European Union can't get behind his own government's plan for leaving the European Union after having 2 years to put together a plan on how we would leave the European Union. You've got Jacob Rees-Mogg, who's become the sort of de facto leader of the furiously hard of thinking, insisting that it's all a question of believing without telling us what it is he's supposed to believe in, or indeed without accounting for the circumstances in which we're supposed to think he knows more about running Jaguar, Land Rover, Siemens, Airbus, Rolls-Royce, Nissan, Toyota, I could go on, than the people who run Jaguar, Land Rover, Airbus, Siemens, Toyota, Nissan. How deferential would you have to be to think, yeah, I'm going to ignore the governor of the Bank of England and I'm going to listen to a bloke whose investment fund has just opened in Dublin with advice to investors that Brexit is going to cause uncertainty and instability? See, he's obliged by law to put that in his prospectus, as I understand it. He's not obliged by law to tell the truth when he's talking to newspapers or to you. And that's why he can get away with saying things like, they just don't believe enough. They just don't believe. Believe in what? 03456060973. I believe in the Beatles. A bunch of questions, but to be honest with you, it's one of those days where the pleasure of saying I told you so is absolutely zilch. It was always going to happen like this, unless you subscribe to the school of thought that says, I have no idea what's going to happen. I fully accept that things are probably going to get worse, but I still want to leave because they're the only people now that will still be falling into line behind the Rees-Moggs of this world. But there are still millions of them. Marco's in Willesden Green. Marco, what would you like to say?
Hello there, James. And first of all, I've just been to the dentist and I'm speaking really weird. That's why.
Yeah, but we don't know what you sound like the rest of the time, Marco. So there's
right,
no
that's right.
Carry on.
But I passionately believe. Yeah. So the hubris, I think, set in as soon as Theresa May started waving the flag and saying that we were going to have a red, white, and blue Brexit. Mm. That somehow we were going to get this special deal.
But did she not have to do that to keep the Daily Mail and the Sun happy?
You could argue that, but it was...
I know what's going to happen today. I'm going to get...
Extremely naive.
Yeah, of course it is, but if that's all that matters... The editor of The Sun was at Downing Street on Friday night, mate, before they went to Chequers. I mean, for some reason, they still Labour, and this is where the disconnect between the Tories and Corbyn's Labour is so huge. Mm. They're still in hock to the dying print media. Corbyn is riding the wave of modern social and non-traditional media. Theresa May had to come out. As someone who campaigned to Remain, she had to come out and go peak unicorn. She had to say Brexit means Brexit. Otherwise, they'd have crucified her, I think.
Well, I'd argue that she could have toned her language down a bit. The problem with the negotiating strategy on that front is she went all out with the red, white and blue Brexit, no deal is better than a bad deal, all of that kind of nonsense.
Yes.
And what that was a gift to the EU, because it basically pulled the EU together. So the EU negotiating team and the countries in the EU... said, OK, well, if they're going to take that stance, we will pull together even harder.
Isn't it? I don't even know if that's true. They've established their position from the very start. Isn't it this? If we had to, and I don't want to nail it at 20 past 10, because I'm here till 1. I'm here all week. Try the veal. I don't see how anything could work without admitting reality. Do you see what I mean? This is what the plan did this weekend. Yeah. It had to admit reality. Rees-Mogg doesn't have to admit reality. Arguably, David Davis doesn't have to admit reality now. You pore over his resignation letter. It doesn't contain a single syllable of detail on what he would want to do differently or how he would be able to do things differently. But Theresa May denied reality for 2 years, certainly for 18 months since triggering Article 50, because the reality is it will be worse than what we currently have in almost every measurable way. And she can't say that. Because, as Jacob Rees-Mogg demonstrated with Nick earlier, it's not about demonstrable evidence, it's about believing. So you can say the truth, and then Rees-Mogg stands up and say, I believe the opposite of the truth, and people cheer him. This is religious now. This isn't even psychological. It's moved beyond political, past psychological, into religion. It's all about believing, despite all of the evidence of your own eyes and ears.
But don't you think, James, it would have been far better to believe in to understand the reality and to admit the reality while she had the power and while she had the...
I don't know. My theory... I'll give you 50-50 on that. The short answer is I just don't know. My feeling is, and I suspect this reflects what they felt at the time, my feeling is that she'd have been hauled over the coals by the Daily Mail and the Sun, who again don't have to deal with reality. I mean, they are the very definition of news outlets that simply sell religious fervour. They sell belief. And the fear of being hauled over the coals by them is what stayed her hand on being more honest more early. But whether or not it would have destroyed her premiership, whether or not they would have brought her down, I guess we will never know. 22 minutes after 10 is the time. What is it that Jacob Rees-Mogg and his forelock-tugging followers actually believe in that the rest of us who subscribe to reality and evidence still can't quite see? Paul's in Western Supermare. Paul, what would you like to say?
Good morning, James.
Hello.
Hi. As I see it, really, I understand you're saying that it's not reality, but the reality is that 17.4 million people voted to leave the European Union for one reason or another, whether it's for sovereignty or for immigration or whatever it was.
Well it's important to focus on what the reasons were before we can establish whether or not they were rational
absolutely.
And sound reasons. So sovereignty, we know, was never surrendered. The first white paper that was published by Parliament stated very baldly the British Parliament has always been sovereign. What we learnt this weekend is that the powers they spent 40 years telling us we didn't have, we actually did have all along, because now they're worried that they're going to have to surrender them to Brussels. And as you know, Article 2 of the Citizens' Charter makes it abundantly clear that successive governments, both Labour and Conservative, could have had a lot more robust immigration policies if they thought that they were for the good of the country, but they didn't, so we didn't. So all of the votes you've just mentioned were cast on... at best a misconception, at worst a downright deceit. But carry on.
I mean, yeah, the other reason I voted to leave as well was because of democracy. I mean, in the day, those guys in Brussels aren't elected by us. And
the MEPs are.
It's very simply telling us what to do.
We elect the British MEPs. You elect one MP in Weston-super-Mare. You have no say at all over the other 640. So that parallels bogus as well.
The people who've really got the power, the European Council, the European Commission.
Which is appointed by the European Parliament and can be removed by those democratically elected members of the European Parliment. But anyway, carry on. Let's try again.
Of course it is.
It's just as likely as a cabinet to be overthrown by Parliament, which we could easily see happening this week.
I would compare the European Council to the House of Lords.
Okay, mate. Will you carry on doing that? And now you can answer my question. What is it you believe in that Jacob Rees-Mogg so beautifully embodies?
I just want Britain to be Britain. I don't want to be told what to do by another country, by the European Union. This whole project was started in 1954 by the Bilderberg Group and the EUSSR.
You didn't just say EUSSR, did you, Paul?
I did indeed, James. Okay. Yes, I did indeed. The EUSSR, which is a super state which they've tried
it's
to build.
25 past 10. Go on.
I know, yeah. And
super state, EUSSR, and Bilderberg Group.
Shown to be complete failure.
Just stay there. I'm going to be a little bit rude, but I mean it very affectionately. So if you voted to leave and you're listening to Paul and you're thinking, well, crikey, he's mad. I'm not on his side. Don't sit there being rude about Paul with his EUSSR and his Bilderberg group and his belief and the 1954 whatever. Ring in and give me your reasons. Don't just sit there mocking him or claiming that he's been specially selected because he's silly or he's using these ludicrous catchphrases. Ring in and give me your reasons. Tell me what it is you believe in. So, Paul, given that the picture you paint of the European Union is so unutterably awful, would it be fair to say that you don't care how bad things get afterwards, you will still somewhere inside be able to convince yourself that it was a good idea to leave?
I don't think that the things that Airbus and Jaguar Land Rover are saying, I think they're holding us to ransom. I really do. I believe that these corporations are holding us to ransom, saying, look, if you don't stay in, this is going to happen, this is what's going to happen. And I think...
Talk me through the logic of that position. Airbus and Siemens and Jaguar Land Rover are describing how their just-in-time supply chains work, and you think they're lying. So what can I ask what your experience or knowledge of... just-in-time supply.
I don't have any experience. That's all I'm in.
So where do you derive your confidence that the people who don't just have experience of it, but who actually run it, are either being wrong-headed or deceptive? Where do you get? Because this is where it gets religious, Paul. And I fear you don't realise this, because what you're saying now is here is all of the available evidence, but I believe it's wrong. Where do you derive that confidence from?
We only have to look at when George Osborne and Cameron said it was going to go to absolute tits when it first happened.
You're talking about two politicians now who were campaigning to remain within the European Union. I'm interested where you derive your confidence that you have a better grasp of what Jaguar Land Rover, Siemens, Airbus, Nissan, Toyota, and sundry other companies are doing. You have a better grasp of what they're doing than the people who actually run them. I'm fascinated because I almost envy you.
No, I don't purport to have that. I don't purport to have that.
But you did. You said they were blackmailing us. You said that they weren't. Yes, so it's your personal opinion. I want to know what it's built on. Could you give me a precedent? Have you ever been right in the past when the head of a multinational company says one thing and you say, I know better? Have you ever been right in the past?
No, but I believe that they're all part of it.
You do what? What was that verb you just used?
They.
No, the verb.
Sorry. The verb?
Yeah, you said, I believe.
I believe that they're all part of the same group. Yeah, I do. Like, indeed, it's a big club, if you like.
How would the owners of the Ritz fit into your perception of a club that secretly runs the world?
I don't know the owners of the Ritz, as I say, but certainly the corporations. I mean, the builder...
You don't think the Ritz is a corporation? We're going to have to go. What... In a rational universe, can you imagine anything that would make you wake up one morning and go, I can't believe I used to bang on about the Bilderberg Group in the EUSSR?
The Bilderberg Group is not conspiracy, it's fact.
Its existence is a fact. The idea that it secretly runs the world is absolutely pant-wetting insane. But I guess that is where the religion truly kicks in. God bless you. and all who's sailing you. Theo Usherwood is here with some astonishingly exciting news.
Dominic Raab is taking over from David Davis as the Brexit Secretary. Dominic Raab voted Leave in the referendum, campaigned for Leave, was Minister of State at the Department for Housing and Communities, and gets the big job to run DEXU, the Department for Exiting the European Union, replaces David Davis. I've also just landed in my inbox of the letters between Steve Baker, the Minister of State, who, of course, is also going to need to be replaced, and the Prime Minister.
But arguably have quite a lot on his plate as the investigation into the funding of Vote Leave continues, isn't he?
Yes.
As well. So he might be perhaps resigning to spend more time with his accountant.
And lawyers. I acknowledge the parliamentary opinion and arithmetic which constrain the government's freedom of action, but I cannot support this policy with the sincerity and resolve which will be necessary. I therefore write with regret to resign from the government.
Any mention of the policy he could support in that letter?
No.
Oh, weird, because that's exactly the same as David Davis.
No.
And they just believe, don't they? They don't need policies because they believe.
Yes, and then we have the letter back from the Prime Minister, short and concise, unlike the one to David Davis. You have approached your work with great diligence and sincerity, helping us to deliver on the result which for which you campaigned so passionately during the referendum. And, of course, she's given... She's given him a demotion in that letter. That probably signifies the terseness with which it's been responded to. She's described him as a parliamentary undersecretary of state. In fact, he was the minister of state at the Department for Leaving the European Union.
The madness! The fun continues.
But that's, and then of course we're expecting a Boris Johnson press conference this afternoon, and Theresa May up in the House of Commons at 3:30 or shortly afterwards.
And it's Boris Johnson press conference. Andrea Leadsom about to appear on the telly. Suella Braverman resigning and then unresigning. Is that?
Yes. She was just being seen walking down Whitehall.
Almost as if none of these people have the first idea what they're playing at, isn't it? And do you remember what David Davis said in the very first... On the 26th of May 2016, this is the point for me where everybody should really... And I appreciate that my Pied Pipering skills have not proved to be particularly effective. It's taken two years to be proved absolutely right about everything. But when David Davis tweeted, "The first calling point of the UK's negotiator immediately after Brexit will not be Brussels, it will be Berlin, to strike a deal," I sat and stared at that, genuinely. And I thought, surely now... people are going to realise that these clowns have no idea. Not only is he demonstrating abject ignorance of how the negotiations will work, he's displaying abject ignorance of how the European Union legislation works. And if he doesn't understand the European Union legislation, how could he possibly have been campaigning to leave it?
But the point that Theresa May made when she appointed David Davis to DEXU and to Liam Fox to International Trade and Boris Johnson to the Foreign Office was that there was buy-in, that they were going to be part of these negotiations, James. They were going to be leading these negotiations. That they wouldn't, at the end of these negotiations, be able to say, nothing to do with me, we didn't sign up to this, this isn't what the referendum was about. And of course, David Davis, by resigning, he's put his name to the fact that at the end he won't vote for it. And that's what Jacob Rees-Mogg was saying this morning.
And yes, because they believe in something different that they can't describe. It's 10:32. Thank you, Theo. Simon Conway's here now with the headlines. It is now clear that the Brexit debate divides along beliefs. Belief in evidence versus a belief in an as-yet unspecified future that Jacob Rees-Mogg accuses Theresa May of not believing in enough. What is this thing that he believes in that I currently don't? Perhaps you could help me believe. With the greatest of love and respect to Paul in Weston-super-Mare, I don't think you're going to convert me to the cause by citing the EUSSR and the Bilderberg Group. Because that's mad. But this is the whole point about the disinformation campaign that's been running in this country now for a few years. Putin and the Kremlin and the other disruptors who are from the other side of the political spectrum traditionally, the kind of far-right, alt-right, dark money that American billionaires have poured into things like Cambridge Analytica and Breitbart and all of those other organisations designed to corrupt the truth. They don't care what you believe, as long as objective truth is dead. So, Paul, bless him, he believes this stuff. Nobody actually sits there going, ha-ha, yes, there's a bloke in Weston-super-Mare who believes in the Bilderberg Group. But that is enough, you see, to stop him from believing in expertise, evidence and observable truth. So here are all the bosses of all the big companies in Britain lining up to say, don't do this, do not do this. Paul has been given just enough to allow him to believe that they're somehow up to no good, they're somehow not to be trusted. And when you ask him what his basis for that is, words like Bilderberg Group come out and EU-SSR without the poor fellow realising just how played he has been. And the people who've played him don't care what he believes, as long as, just as we've seen in America, you heard it on Friday with that bloke in Crawley ringing in to describe things he'd seen with his own eyes on a television screen in front of him as fake news. Because once you've done that, you can get people to do anything you want. Absolutely anything you want. You can get them to kill themselves because they think the world is going to end tomorrow at 2 o'clock. That's how cults work. 03456060973. So the questions we're addressing, and you're welcome to add many to the list. What is it that Jacob Rees-Mogg believes in that Theresa May doesn't? Put it into actual words, words that could be written down and turned into a negotiating strategy or a plan for the country's future. And no one's had a go at this yet. Does anyone know what David Davis has been doing for the last 2 years? What have we been paying him for? I wonder what his political epitaph will actually be. I would vote for this.
And you'd been there all night, and the Prime Minister had been there all night.
No, we went out in the middle of the night, basically. We went out, very early morning. That was because there were other things. You know, bear in mind, we started on Monday.
Yes.
And
was that as calamitous as it appeared in some quarters of the media? It did look like a very dark day, Mr. Davis.
Well, no, not really. I mean,
respectfully, the Prime Minister getting a phone call halfway through lunch.
Yeah, I know. But I listened to it, and it was quite a lot shorter than people say as well. But what's the requirement of my job? I mean, I don't have to be very clever. I don't have to know that much. I do just have to be calm. And that's that did test the calmness.
So he doesn't have to be very clever. He doesn't have to be able to do the job. He just has to stay very calm. It absolutely beggars belief. Can we clip that up? I'm gonna use that as a punctuation mark in the programme, just a bit of from what are the requirements of my job. What has he been doing for the last 2 years? And if you're one of the people doffing your cap and tugging, let me be a little bit kinder. If you're one of the people still persuaded that these men and women are anything but chancers, charlatans, or just industrially dense, just so dense that they can't understand the simplest things, what do they have to do for you to lose faith in them? Lloyd's in Neasden. Lloyd, what would you like to say?
Good morning, James. Before we go any further, good morning. I'm so dismayed, James. I've got so much to say, so little time. It's just...
Well, don't waste it. Don't waste any of it telling us how much you've got to say and how little time you've got.
Okay. I think you haven't got... You just haven't got a chance, James. I've been listening to you for quite a while. When this first kicked off, people were ringing you left, right and centre, and you were tearing them to shreds. Someone had to ring in and say to you, or text and say to you, James, your little style of... What would you be able to do tomorrow that you can't do today was a bit too harsh, and it was like it was getting like a blood sport. It was, and I've seen the calls diminish to you because you just seem to just, it's like you're some sort of world champion. You even back down Nigel Farage in the interview, and
that's not very difficult, mate. To be honest with you,
but these people, they are actually following. You've got the Nigel Farages. I blame part of your profession. I blame your profession because you've got certain people in your profession that will listen to stuff, will listen to calling in, and won't say to them, but hold on a minute, explain, how are you going to do that? They just allow people to say,
you can say what you like about that bloke, but the rest of my colleagues are honourable and decent people who might have been mistaken in some of their beliefs. You've got to remember that people have spent, particularly working in, if you're working in right-wing politics or right-wing media, you've spent 40 years essentially not just believing but disseminating the sort of claptrap that Paul in Western Supermare just regurgitated. You might not have gone quite as far as the Bilderberg Group, but you've certainly probably gone a little bit EU-SSR at some point, and it's never occurred to you in 40 years, or certainly in 30 years since Johnson arrived in Brussels as the Daily Telegraph correspondent after being fired by the Times for making up quotes from his own godfather, it's certainly not occurred to them in 30 years that this enemy, this appalling... enemy is the only word I can use. This enemy of Britain was actually... a thing we were in, and quite a good thing we were in. Flawed, imperfect, but you can't... You're asking people to suddenly stop believing in God or to stop believing in Satan. And they've spent their whole lives believing it, with very little evidence, but it's the belief that's so strong.
I know, but James, listen, I'm not going to name, but I rang one of your colleagues and I said to them...
No, I don't like this. I'm not comfortable with
it. No, James. Right. I'm not going to put you in a position. I'm not going to put you in a position, I promise. Okay. So the argument was about Brexit and I said 3 points. But one of the main points I said was on a programme in the morning, you have a fella talking and he has constantly said that David Davis said, when we leave, we can do deals with Berlin.
Yes.
It had to be pointed out to him on a few occasions that we can't.
The first calling point of the UK's negotiator immediately after Brexit will not be Brussels, it will be Berlin to strike a deal. The point at which I thought everybody would realise David Davis doesn't know what day it is. And that was in May. That was before the referendum result even came in. But, I don't follow things as closely as I do, Lloyd.
But when I rang in and I said this to this presenter on your programme, yeah, who I know follows his Twitter feed, I know knows him personally, and that person said to that best person on radio poo-pooed me. Even
he poo-pooed you.
Basically, what he said, he said.
Yeah, well, look, mate, I'm not here to provide you with therapy for getting disrespected and possibly misled by somebody else on that. Look, if I was going to be taking account of all the callers to everybody else's show, I wouldn't have time to get any callers to mine. So, listen, you're clearly right. I think it's fairly clear who you're talking about. I think you're talking about Ian. And if he didn't know about this tweet, that's forgivable. I mean, he's loyal to his friends. But I don't want to talk about other presenters. I want to talk about you. What do they believe in that we don't? If you could put it in a sentence, this thing that Jacob Rees-Mogg was talking about believing. Theresa May doesn't believe. What is it that they believe that we don't?
They don't believe in Royal Britannia. They don't believe in the form of Great Britain that used to own the world and control the world and drew all the lines around the world and made...
Well, no, they believe in that because that's historical fact, but they don't believe that it's easily regainable. They don't believe that we
could... They believe that we still have that muscle mass. That muscle mass hasn't depleted. We still have it. We're just not using it.
Yeah.
Like an old bodybuilder.
Now that applies to some of them. Do you think that applies to the ones I would previously have described as sensible? Because this notion of English exceptionalism becomes very powerful because it doesn't matter what the evidence is. You just believe that we'll be brilliant. Look, here's all the blokes saying and all the women saying we won't be, all the people who run the actual business. Yeah, but what do they know? Bloke who runs Airbus is a German.
I think that when you see Liam Fox going to a rally up north and standing there like he's a rock star and actually saying afterwards, I never believed I would get this reception. I think that sort of stuff is addictive. And I think some people have suddenly find themselves with 17.5 million fans.
Yeah.
Out of nowhere. And they are suddenly like godlike. When they go to rallies, they're like, we're going to... And it's
so
like, it's addictive.
It's 17.5 million people voted to give all of the country's money to the Dragon Slayers because the Dragon Slayers had done such a magnificent job of describing the dragons. And all of the people who've pointed out that dragons don't exist need to shut up and get over it because the will of the people is to give all of the money and the power to the Dragon Slayers.
Yeah, but you see...
And then the Dragon Slayers come into town and they get cheered to the rafters. And if you're a Dragon Slayer getting cheered to the rafters, you're going to try and prolong the penny drop moment for as long as possible, aren't you?
Yes, and that phrase that you just used that keeps coming up, there should be a law and a rule on the radio station. When people say, we voted for that, the alarm bell should go on because you should say... They should say half the country voted for that.
Half the country didn't vote for anything, mate. Half the country. I mean, you had prominent Brexit campaigners saying we'd be like Norway. You had prominent Brexit campaigners saying we'd be like Switzerland. I know that some of the Brexit supporters on this radio station are supremely comfortable with freedom of movement, but they believe that we'll have some sort of magical trading skills suddenly developed, despite the fact that the bloke who's been running the department to get us out for 2 years has resigned without having done anything for 2 years. You're right about the English exceptionalism, but you're not right that half the country... And you know you're not. I'm being a bit unkind. I'm picking your words. There's no earthly way that anyone can argue 17.5 million people voted for anything except leaving. And that's where you are now. I don't care what happens as long as we leave. As long as we leave. Even if we sink slowly beneath the waves, even if my children are poorer, even if the fruit rots in the field, even if I lose my job, even if Jaguar Land Rover moves out of the country, even if Airbus goes to Hamburg, even if Nissan and Toyota move to continental Europe, they'll still be able to sell their cars to us. I suppose if you really wanted to make a killing, now might be the time to invest in a penny farthing factory. It's 10:47. I believe I can fly. You believe in the Beatles. I believe I can touch the sky. Jacob Rees-Mogg believes in something that Theresa May doesn't believe in. I just want you to tell me what it is. 0345 60 60 973. I love that phrase from the last fella, depleted muscle mass. There is this sense that patriotism somehow involves believing in a Britain that no longer exists, that hasn't really existed since the dawn of the First World War. And I don't know, how do you reach out to people like that? How do you point out to them? Look, show them the England team. There's so much to be proud of, that magnificent England team that is just doing the country so, so proud, represents what I would describe loosely as modernity, modern Britain, modern England, as opposed to what the Jacob Rees-Mogg School of Brexiting seems to represent, which is a mythical past. I think, anyway, but I don't want to put words in your mouth. You tell me what you think it is he and you believe in that me and Theresa May don't. 0345 60 60 973. And no answers yet to the vexed question of what do we think David Davis has been doing for the last 2 years? Has anyone seen him around? Maybe he's sort of, maybe he's built a massive ride-on train set in his back garden. I mean, what would you do if you had 2 years on 120 grand a year without actually having to do any work? 4 hours he spent with Michel Barnier, apparently. What would you have done? I think I was about to say, actually, but I don't want to jinx it. I think I've pretty much finished my book. But that didn't take 2 years, and I had a day job throughout, doing all sorts of gigs on the side and things like that. What's David Davis been doing for 2 years? I think I'd... Do you know, remember Fred Dibner? We talked about Fred Dibner last week, the former steeplejack who became a television star because he had such a lovely way with himself and his enthusiasm for all things mechanical and industrial was utterly infectious. Fred Dibner, I think I'm right in saying, dug a coal mine in his own back garden just as a hobby because it was there. I might have a crack at that. Has anyone seen David Davis's back garden lately? Has he dug a mine there? Maybe he's just dug an enormous hole. No, I mean literally, not politically and career. Obviously, he's done it metaphorically. He spent 2 years digging an enormous hole that he's now tried to climb out of with some success. But maybe he's actually just dug a really, really... When I was a kid, I was fascinated by the idea of getting to Australia by digging through the rockery at the bottom of our garden in Kidderminster. And because I chose to start on the rockery, I didn't even reach the level of the lawn. The rockery was kind of mounted up. It was higher. But I used to dig every Sunday morning. I'd go out, Mum and Dad would have a lie-in, and I'd go out there and just dig and dig and dig and dig. So can anyone just have a look over David Davis's garden fence? Maybe he's just been digging a really big hole for 2 years. Or possibly he's built a little ride-on train set or a coal mine. Or he's got a kit car in the garage that he's putting together. What else do men of that sort of age do as hobbies? No? Just the kit car, then? Jordan's in Godalming. Jordan, what is going on?
Jordan,
I'm interrupting you before you've even started talking. Have you noticed how many Jordans there are out there? It's been astonishing. But Jordan Pickford, Jordan Henderson, Jordan is the coming name. My mate Jordan out of Rizzle Kicks, I had no idea. I didn't know any Jordans socially until relatively recently. It's
there's
one of those. It's come out of nowhere. Is it in the charts?
Honestly, it's good. I mean, yeah, many reasons.
Jordan. What did you ring in to say?
I can tell you what Jacob Rees-Mogg believes in.
Yes.
Well, I think I can. I can't say in certainty. No one can speak in certainties.
No,
but I think, I'm pretty sure he believes in himself. So if you take that as read, if he believes in himself, then he's not being, well, he is being patriotic. He's being patriotic to himself. He's, you know, benefiting himself in the mess. You know, the company he works for part-time moves itself to Ireland, so it doesn't...
No, only one fund has moved to Ireland, and he explained how that is not the same as moving an office. It just means that the fund will be free to operate under European Union law after the country has left.
Well, true, but whilst he stands on the other side and says... Abject nonsense.
Everything's great.
I always feel like every time he speaks, you should, you know, at the end of adverts, they have that little white title which tells you the real APR and what you're really buying. Every time he speaks, they should have that underneath them. What you're really buying into is this.
Small print. You're right. Everyone should have small print. I remember when that was the job of journalists, actually, to provide the small print when politicians were bloviating. But the point I don't want to allow you to get away with. Because he can believe in himself, but what does his future look like? What does the future he believes in actually look like?
Well, I presume the one he believes in would be rosy, right? I mean, I heard him described by a member of the public on this radio station this morning as a man they could get behind. in terms of another election.
Yes.
You know, I mean, that's rosy, right? That's what this guy, this B-lister, this guy that used to wheel out for Question Time to sit on the far right, and the guy used to come out and do Have I Got News For You, and be great and fantastic, and he's wonderfully charismatic, and
sure.
That's one of the words charismatic.
But this is the thing that I heard John Humphreys interview David Davis earlier, and he didn't ask what the alternative is, because they're hecklers. We've said for 2 years the hecklers have been invited onto the stage.
What if this brings out somebody who's more red tooth than red fanged? Wasn't that John Humphrey's
word? What does that even mean?
I don't know what it means. I mean, maybe someone like Moggy will come up and stand out and say abject nonsense.
And go unchallenged. And I suppose if you want to talk abject nonsense and go unchallenged, the best place you can go is sit opposite John Humphreys in the Today programme studio at the moment. But there is the problem. You didn't ask David Davis what the alternative is. Jacob Rees-Mogg hasn't explained what the alternative is. And if you push him on it, he talks about beliefs. Jordan, how old are you?
27.
What's the cut-off age for Jordan? When did Jordan start taking over the world?
Well, I don't know. I'm a history teacher, so I'll give a plug at it. So basically, when knights from the Crusade were going over to the Holy Land, they'd baptise themselves in the River Jordan and take on the name and then come back, and it'd be like a mark to say, oh, I've been on.
But there were no Jordans around in Kidderminster in the 1970s and 80s, mate. When did it kick off in the 21st century? When did it become a thing? In the last decade of the last millennium, was it, roughly?
I don't know, yeah. I think
you an old Jordan at 27?
I presume so, whatever that means. I mean, yeah.
My eldest is fascinated by names, and it's actually quite contagious. Jordan, thank you. Dan, what a prosaic, boring name that is. Dan's in Leicester. Dan, what would you like to say?
Well, 30,
it's not short for Jordan, is it? Might be short for Jordan. Oh, all right.
I resent that. But anyway, you're asking a bunch of questions this morning, dude.
Only two. What does Jacob Rees-Mogg believe in, and what has David Davis been doing for the last 2 years?
Well, there was the whole thing about belief as well, and that's what got me to call you.
Yes.
I don't think it's about belief now. It's about the right to self-determination, if you want to give it a name. It's if you're a Brexiter, you voted to leave, and nobody, particularly not an elite, elected or otherwise, is going to tell you otherwise. You're mad as hell and you're just not going to take it anymore, that kind of thing.
But then you say, what did leaving mean? And they can't tell
Doesn't
you.
Matter.
Or there's 17 and a half million different answers.
Doesn't
so is it, it's just like a baby that's had its dummy taken away. And if you do not give the dummy back, they'll scream and scream and scream until they're sick.
There's that, but I wouldn't... that sounds a little bit patronising, and that really gets Brexiters back.
But we've spent 2 years trying not to be patronising, and they keep defecating in their hands and then clapping in public. How can you not patronise them?
Well, they believe they're in a fight for the right to self-determination, and that because they were told
they've
they
spent
could have
this
it,
weekend saying they've spent they've spent this weekend saying that we'll have to give all those powers to Brussels under this deal, and 40 years saying that we didn't have the powers in the first place. I mean, how can they sustain these self-contradicting positions? That's what I find astonishing, and that's why it is about belief, isn't it?
Well, they don't have to justify any of their positions, because if you talk to any Brexiter and you press them hard enough, they fall back on the numbers. 17.4 million people voted for it, and that's why we're doing it.
Voted for 17.4 million different things, most of which have been proven not to be true.
Well, that's covered by Brexit means Brexit, whatever you want it to mean.
So why did David Davis resign? I love the way the music came up there. Now it was almost like we produced this programme. Go on, why did David Davis resign? Dun, dun, dun. Over to you, Dan.
I have absolutely no idea, but
no.
I know what his job was for the last 2 years.
Go on.
Well, they called him the knuckle duster, right? The old knuckle duster. It's very Churchillian.
Knucklehead.
His job was to be us in front of Europe, like every man.
He's only spent 4 hours there. He said it was going to be the row of the summer at one point, do you remember? And it was all done and dusted by the end of the super course. I mean, the man is an absolute joke. And I guess the only way you can sustain the idea that he's not an absolute joke is simply by believing that he isn't. Here is all of the evidence, the quotes, the tapes, the demonstrations, the statistics. Ah, yes. But I believe in David Davis. One of those rare days where everyone is in complete agreement. Brexit is an unmitigated disaster, and anybody who pretends otherwise is now fully, fully inculted, if that's a word. I'm only joking. There's no agreement at all. So why do you think David Davis resigned? 0345 6060973. Answer, because once it's written down, it's impossible to defend. It's impossible to defend because nobody can argue that what they are going to end up with is better than what we've currently got. So the only people left now throwing rotten tomatoes from the back of the hall, heckling from the side of the stage, are the people who won't tell you what the future looks like. They'll just tell you that you need to believe in it. That's all that's left. Believe in something better. And that is the only way, as far as I can tell, in which someone like Jacob Rees-Mogg can genuinely have convinced himself that he knows more about how to run Jaguar Land Rover than the bloke who runs Jaguar Land Rover. And that's why I don't get cross with people like Paul. I got a bit cross with Paul in Western Supermare when he talked about the Bilderberg Group, because that is, I mean, it's such an abnegation of intellectual responsibility. I appreciate how comforting it is just to grab a meaningless slogan or conspiracy and use it to cloak your complete ignorance of complicated facts, but he sounded bright enough to have worked stuff out for himself. As soon as he's handed something like control our borders, we want our country back, Bilderberg Group, EU-SSR, he's given freedom to switch off his brain. And I understand the seductive nature of invitations to switch off your brain. Thinking very, very rarely makes you feel better about the world. It usually makes you feel worse, which is why empty slogans like Make America Great Again and Lock Her Up are so powerful and so seductive to people who know that thinking hurts. But you can't get cross with him if people like Rees-Mogg are getting away with it, you know, on the telly. People like David Davis getting away with it on the radio. You can't get cross with ordinary punters for somehow thinking that belief can trump fact, or that they know more about why Jaguar Land Rover and Airbus and Siemens and all of the others are saying and doing what they're doing. You got people like David Davis and Rees-Mogg standing up in public claiming that they know more about running Jaguar Land Rover than the bloke who runs Jaguar Land Rover. You can't get cross with a punter in Western Supermare who's persuaded himself that he knows more about why they're doing what they're doing than they do. I just don't think it's helpful. I know a lot of people get cross with me for not getting more cross with them, but there's enough crossness out there. There's enough anger. People have soiled themselves, politically speaking, on an epic scale. 17.5 million people effectively have soiled themselves. You either help them clean it up, or you just shout at them. Shouting at them's not going to help. And admittedly, not all of them realise what they've done yet, or indeed would welcome attempts to help them clean themselves up, but that is where we're going to end up, however this plays out. Whether or not we're cleaning up the whole country from the perspective of having deliberately diminished ourselves, or whether or not we're just trying to deal with the bruised egos of the people who hopefully won't be able to continue seeking to persuade themselves that they haven't soiled themselves by just saying, I believe that I haven't. What does Jacob Rees-Mogg believe in? What has David Davis been doing for the last 2 years? And why, in your words, did he resign? And as ever on this programme, on a day like today, any other angle you please. Joe's in Leeds. Joe, what would you like to say?
Hi, mate. Wish I could tell you a bit more about David Davis, but I think I know about as much as anyone else does.
2 years, mate. Hang on a minute. Let's just. I was going to play that clip again. I'll be back with you in a second, because some people have only just tuned in at 11.
What's the requirement of my job? I mean, I don't have to be very clever. I don't have to know that much. I do just have to be calm.
Oh, dear. If only Nero was here with his violin. Sorry, Joe. Back to you, mate.
Yeah, so on this belief thing, I don't know, man. I feel like it may be coming at it from the wrong point of view.
Possibly.
I mean, you ask people who go for Brexit and you say, what do you believe in, or what do you see coming in 5, 10 years? No one really has an answer. But you ask them about what they don't want to happen, and, you know, there's a straight answer there. It's the same with people in America, you know, Trump supporters. No one really has a clear view of what they want to happen, but everyone knows exactly what they don't want to happen. I don't know whether it's a belief thing. Belief seems to be, like, pinning too much hope on this. I don't think people have a lot of hope.
Jacob Rees-Mogg used the word. That's why I reached for it. He said Theresa May doesn't believe in Brexit. What does that mean?
Well, I don't think Theresa May knows at all what Brexit means. No one knows what Brexit means.
Well, no one honest claims to know what it means. Everybody honest or informed knows that it will involve, they like to say, in the short term, and we knew that all along, which is another barefaced lie, but they know that it will involve diminishment and decline.
Mm-hmm.
They claim that it won't be forever, but they've got no evidence to back that up. So how can you possibly sell a plan to the people or to the parliament which acknowledges the reality of inevitable decline and diminishment while somehow simultaneously claiming improvement and enhancement?
I don't want to put words in other people's mouths, you know, but it seems that there's a tacit understanding that the people who are Remainers are for our country going on and being economically prosperous, and the people who are Brexiteers, perhaps some of them, are willing to accept some kind of diminishment of our country in order for certain other aspects of our national life to either be re-established...
Like what? Don't mince your words. I know you don't want to put words into other people's mouths, but are you just... I mean, the most obvious one is they're hoping there'll be fewer foreigners around. But they don't mean the foreigners they know. They just mean the ones they've read about in the Daily Mail and the Sun.
Of course, because we all know that the most Leave voting constituents, the ones that don't want to have immigrants, are also the ones are least likely to have immigrants in their own constituents.
So they're the most easy to spook.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. But what, like, I think there's a lot of focus on kind of, you know, what are the Brexit, you know, what do the Brexiteers want? What are these people who like Brexit? What are they hoping for? What are they hoping for? And I think if we want to really reach these people, we need to be addressing the fact that they have fears, which may or may not be irrational, but that's what's driving.
But they won't admit it. They won't admit that they've got irrational feelings. They claim they've got a deep understanding of things like the Bilderberg Group and the secret plans of the man running Jaguar Land Rover. And you laugh, and you're right to laugh, and you know, the notion that you can conduct these conversations without being patronising is patently absurd. It was stupid even to try. Nobody knows that better than I do. But what do you do after you've finished laughing? Because they still believe in the Bilderberg Group and that they've got a better understanding of running Jaguar Land Rover than the people that run Jaguar Land Rover. It's just like a sort of weapon grade stubborn ignorance, and what I need is the key to unlock it, and God knows what that key is. I've got a horrible feeling the key to unlock it will be experience, which can only be achieved by jumping off the cliff without a parachute.
Well, when you find it, mate, when you find it, let me know.
Well, you're supposed to ring in with it, Joe. In other news, I found a 34-year-old Jordan who claims that he's the oldest Jordan he knows. Joel's son is 28, and apparently at the time it was quite an unfashionable name. A couple of theories on where it comes from. Some of you backing the Backstreet Boys, but it's more likely to be the trainers and the basketball player, isn't it? Just a little side order of nomenclature-based trivia. Joe, good man, thank you. 11:11 is the time. Dan is in Sunderland. Dan, that's Leave country. Hello. What's going on?
You see it, Leave Country. I've opened them there. I do feel like a minority. But it is really sort of, to me, what Rees-Mogg believes in, and all these little cronies like Boris and things like that. They believe in keeping themselves in the 1%. And I think that's it. Just the idea that it's an opportunity for them to make money. And that's why they're causing that much havoc, because they're just making sure that their position is sound. For when it does go wrong, they can float off to France or wherever and live out the rest of their life, no one saying, you know, oh, well, we'll try.
Nigel Lawson, of course, was the chairman of Vote Leave, and he does indeed live in France. He's now applied for permanent residency. A couple of the big financial backers either have Belizean citizenship or have applied for European Union passports via Malta. It is odd, that the idea that they make a decision for the rest of the country and then sort of seek to get themselves a little loophole, a little backdoor exit from it. But I don't know that... I don't know, because they're the 1% while they're in the European Union. So the economic argument clearly applies to people who tanked the pound on the night of the referendum itself, and clearly there are still people who are poised to make a fortune if we leave with no deal and the pound goes off a cliff the likes of which we've never seen before. It's gone up a bit today because the likelihood of us calling the whole thing off has increased slightly. Well, every time there's a likelihood of us calling the whole thing off, the pound goes up, and yet anyone who claims an economic basis for wanting to leave the European Union just sort of sticks pencils up their nose at that point and shuts their eyes. But Rees-Mogg's not in this for the money. I mean, admittedly, his fund is legally obliged to tell the truth when they issue a prospectus from Dublin, and admittedly that prospectus states that the uncertainty back in Britain is going to be problematical and damaging. But he's an individual, and he's not protecting money. He's protecting something more nebulous than that. You can't, because it's easy to believe in money. That's not what he means when he says Theresa May doesn't believe in Brexit. He must mean something else. What does he mean?
The only thing I can think, if it's not the money, is that there's obviously some sort of gain for him elsewhere, because he doesn't come across as the type of man who, you know, I can't imagine flying the flag for the people the same way someone like Jeremy Corbyn does. I can't see him out there, you know, in the streets demanding change. I can just see him thinking, I'm not too happy with this. It doesn't suit me that well. I'm going to try and change it. And I just get this feeling of me. But in order to do that, he's got to convince the other people who are around him that it is the right thing to do. And I think that's all they've done, like, since him and Boris, they've convinced, you know, the 52% or whatever it is, that, you know, it's the right thing to do for them.
And none of them can tell you why. They just believe that it is. And as the evidence mounts, the belief seems to kind of ossify, seems to increase.
Yeah, because, I mean, I was having this debate with my dad the other night after the England game, and it just like you say, we just sat there and I was just going around in circles, and that's what happens. They just tell you you're wrong, and then when you try and make a point, you're still wrong. And it's at a point now where I think we will reach a point where someone's going to have to make a decision, or someone's going to have to take responsibility, and it's just going to be pointing fingers.
Well, I don't know when it snaps. Maybe it's March of next year, because you can see it today. David Davis resigns, and Jacob Rees-Mogg goes touring the studios, and they still float the boat that there is some alternative. They're just never ever asked to describe what it is. I mean, that's the bit I find astonishing.
It is terrifying. I mean, the way I think this should be resolved, and I could be wrong, and I'm not, like you say, I'm not the most politically savvy person in the world, but why not negotiate a deal and then give it back to the people? Just say, look, we can either have this deal, leave with no deal, or stay in the EU. And I think then the politicians have given themselves an out by saying, well, you voted for it.
So you have a three-way vote. Here's the deal.
Yeah.
You either stay with what we've got, you chuck everything out the window and burn the house down, or you go with the deal that we've nicked, which both sides have actually agreed to, which we know will be demonstrably worse than we currently have. Problem is, mate, I mean, it depends, you know, if the Kremlin gets its act together again and this weird dark money starts infecting our democracy again, and all of these headbangers and drum beaters who've got very deep and sinister affiliations with all sorts of un-British and indeed anti-British institutions kick in, maybe they could persuade the country to vote to burn the house down without knowing where they're going to sleep tomorrow night.
Well, I mean, the problem is, if we do that, then we've got no one else to blame but ourselves, and we? So I think the politicians love looking for a way out. I think we will find one, or, like you say, what's annoyed me the most since, obviously, the build-up to the referendum started, and since then, is that no one's been held to account over anything. It doesn't. They've said, oh, vote Leave's been fined. Well, who in vote Leave? Well, just vote Leave. Yeah. Right. Well, vote Remain's been fined as well.
Right, but wait for that Electoral Commission report. There may be a little bit more movement in that direction. Certainly the reaction of the vote Leave hierarchy to that Electoral Commission report, the way that they shamefully somehow persuaded the BBC to collaborate on a damage limitation exercise that led the national news that day, suggests to me that they are spooked. 11:17 is the time. Also, of course, reported this weekend that Aaron Banks had many, many, many more visits to the Russian ambassador than he has publicly admitted. Gosh. 11:17. As it all falls apart around your ears, can you give me a ring and tell me why it comforts you to know that people like me are right? Because I've spent 2 years being told, ah, ha, 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 ha. Ha ha ha, Ramona's tears. I don't care what happens as long as people like you are upset. So now I've been proved right. Just tell me how it comforts you that you were wrong all along. 0345 6060 973. What's David Davis been doing for the last 2 years? 0345 6060 973. And in your own words, why has he resigned? In your own words. And underpinning all of this morning's proceedings, Jacob Rees-Mogg told Nick Ferrari earlier that Theresa May doesn't believe in Brexit. Negotiations need to be led by someone who believes in it. Could you put into words what it is he believes that she doesn't? Just into words that make sense. Rational, calm words. A few of you pointing out that I've spoken in the past about religious faith on the programme and my belief in God, as if somehow that trumps my observations about a belief in Brexit. Mate, if I was telling you that you had to give up your job because of my belief in God, you would quite rightly think I was a complete idiot. Yeah? Or if I was telling you that you had to move out of your house and leave your husband because of my belief in God, I believe that God wants you to move out of your house and leave your husband, and you did it because of my belief in God, you'd be an idiot. So there is no comparison here. At the minute that somebody else's belief in God is used as a rationale for that person to tell you what you have to do with your life, who you can marry, who you can go to bed with, whatever it may be, that's when religion goes toxic. So I'm happy to clear that up, but I do so being fairly confident that anybody claiming that they believe there's a parallel to be drawn between religious faith and Brexit faith is being a little bit obtuse, deliberately obtuse, because what Brexit faith does is adopt all of the negativity of religious faith without any of the positivity. My religious faith encourages me to be, or to try to be good to others, to try to be a better person. I fail almost always, but that's the whole point. You try to be. Lots of people with no religious faith spend their lives trying to be better, trying to be decent and kind. Well, Brexit's got none of that to it. All it's got is, I believe X without any proof or evidence whatsoever. And arguably, that belief makes people be vile to each other, be vile to their fellow man, which leads us back to the question of how seeing people like me being proved right is still comforting you when you've spent 2 years saying the best thing about it all is seeing the tears of the Ramonas. Oh, bless. 23 after 11. Mark is in Greenford. Mark, what would you like to say?
Oh, very good morning, James. Hello, just Mark. To lighten the mood a little bit, it's what has David Davis been doing for the last 2 years?
Oh,
a little anecdote.
Yes.
A little anecdote. I was coming back from the European City of Culture, which is Hull.
Oh, yes.
Which is next door to David Davis's constituency. Now, coming back on the train in the evening, on a Saturday evening, sitting in first class, which you can upgrade to for £10.
Mm-hmm.
The train first stop after Hull is Howden.
Howden and Holton Price, isn't it?
That's the one. That's his constituency. Mm. So I'm chatting away with my friend, and David Davis gets on the train, sits opposite. Out comes the iPad, the phone, the notebook. Off comes the coat, the briefcase. Not good evening, hello, sorry, I'm David Davis. I'm busy, I won't be able to talk or any acknowledgement. For 2.5 hours, he sat opposite, arms folded, looking up in the air. Poor steward came round, tried to serve him sandwiches and coffee. David Davis didn't even think it worthy of looking at the man. He just waved.
Perhaps he was meditating, though.
Well, yeah, because he was on the Andrew Marr show the next morning, of course, looking a lot smarter than he did on the train.
Yes, I'm not sure. I mean, I'm enjoying the anecdote, and I shall certainly let you finish it, but I don't know that we should necessarily judge public figures by how they behave on trains. I have behaved quite badly on trains in the past, and I'd be very embarrassed if you were to base your opinion on me upon my behaviour on a train.
However, this is a government minister.
Yes, true.
Who then vacated his seat on, and I'm not exaggerating, 10 occasions, possibly 12.
Possibly, perhaps he had diarrhoea. And that's why he was sitting staring into the sky, because he was, forgive me, the only word I can use here is clenched.
Yes, well, he'd have good reason to clench his buttocks in the job he's been doing. But he left, every time he went to the loo, he left his iPad, his phone, his briefcase open, his coat. And I'm thinking, there must be a protection officer with him looking round. No? No, I'm not exaggerating. 10 or 12 times he went to the loo. Well, this is around the time when the dossiers on business impact with Brexit, whether they existed, whether they didn't. Perhaps he was hoping somebody might steal his iPad and then he'd have an excuse.
But you know what he said about the requirements for doing his job, don't you?
Yes.
Oh, good. Let me just remind you, because I like these outbreaks of harmony. Here are three people in complete agreement, not about the requirements of David Davis, his old job, because I think he was wrong about that, but three people who can completely agree about David Davis's appraisal of his own talents.
What's the requirement of my job? I mean, I don't have to be very clever. I don't have to know that much. I do just have to be calm.
So that was a penny drop moment, surely, for people thinking, hang on, how can he be in charge? He's literally driving and he's just said he doesn't need a licence.
Well, I think that's right. I think, you know, for a guy with his background, you know, when he was a SAS man or whatever he
territorial himself SAS, to be. But I think
the more worrying part now is the Prime Minister's decided not to have David Davis there, but she's appointed Sir Alan Bastard in his place.
He does have a slightly unfortunate facial demeanour, but who knows, maybe he's clenching as well. Were you not tempted to have a little look at his iPad? Because I bet you £50 he's played 8,000 games of Sudoku in the last 2 years.
Well, I was actually genuinely concerned.
Other security. People, mate, we've got a Secretary of State for Defence who activated his own phone by saying Syria in the House of Commons because it sounds a bit like Siri. The idea that these people are grown-ups has surely left the building.
Well, I mean, people in the compartment were looking round at me and thinking,
what's he going to do?
What? You know, I'm not his guard. I'm not looking after his property. Maybe I should have taken the thing and thrown it out the window.
Could have done us all a favour, although it was almost certainly nothing substantive on it. 4 hours of negotiations in 2 years with his oppo, Michel Barnier. By his own admission, a man lacking in both intelligence and acuity, and absolutely no evidence whatsoever that he's done anything for 2 years, but still they cheer because they believe. I would like a musical interlude at this point, but I can't think of one. My favourite song, I believe, is by Tears for Fears. It's a much underrated song off their seminal album, Songs from the Big Chair. One of my all-time favourite. Actually, I must jot that down on my If I Ever Get on Desert Island Discs list. But the other one is from the Book of Mormon, which half a dozen of you have sent me. I shall have a listen to that after the programme and decide whether or not it deserves a bit of amplification today. Richie is in Swansea. Got a couple of minutes, Richie. I hope it's enough. What would you like to say?
Hi, James. Will you correct me if I'm wrong as we go?
That's what I'm here for, Richie.
David Davis has been earning £140,000 a year of taxpayers' money, yes?
So there or thereabouts, yeah.
Well, because David Davis is a public servant,
is
it not the case that he can be formally quizzed by a cross-party group and held to account for his time as office as Brexit minister?
I don't know any now that he's left. I mean, I know he could be before the select committee because Hilary Benn would routinely yes. pull his pants down in the select committee and he'd turn up chewing gum and kind of That's giving right. the impression. I mean, frankly, this is the mystery, Richie, isn't it? Because this is the stuff. Yes. Also, I love hearing the name David Davis said in a Welsh accent. I'm not sure it should ever be said in any other accent, actually. It's got such a lovely ring to it. But this is the point, because we can sit here until we're blue in the face. How can anyone have watched David Davis for the last 2 years and felt encouraged that he was on their side or in charge of negotiations? I don't think I'm ever going to get it.
As a public servant,
yes,
surely he must and can be held to account.
He should be sanctioned. If he was on Universal Credit, he'd be sanctioned.
Absolutely right.
Two years doing nothing. Unless there's something we've not thought of, like he's done some massive... I've got nothing more than just he's dug a huge hole in his garden.
I say one more thing?
You may, Richie.
As a regular listener,
yes.
I'm astonished at the ignorance of opinion.
Mm.
The politically ill-informed and the politically uneducated, which I am one of,
well,
we should never have been given a vote on such a political issue as leaving the EU. We are welders and nurses and shop workers.
And journalists.
We can't be trusted to vote. We can be only trusted to vote for a political direction. The responsibility and intricacies of government belong to our elected members.
I'm inclined to agree with you, although personally I would feel much, much better qualified to cast my vote now than I was 2 years ago. I think probably you would as well. I've learned quite the learning curve. But here was the interesting thing. Another thing that Jacob Rees-Mogg said yesterday was that when he was holding judgment on this agreement that was thrashed out at Chequers, he said he hasn't seen enough detail yet to decide whether or not he can support it. And a few people pointed out that, well, hang on, we cast our votes in June 2016 without any detail whatsoever on a much, much, much more substantive question than anything that was answered by that agreement. So, again, that little low-level, unwitting fraudulence that typifies the man. He needs to see detail before he can decide how he's going to... But he's perfectly comfortable for 17.5 million people who know nothing about the European Union to vote to leave it, and 16-odd million people who know next to nothing about the European Union to vote to remain in it. Funny that, how detail is suddenly relevant.
Quite right. Do you reckon that the Brexit worm is turning?
I don't know. I mean, because I'm so exposed to the knuckle-headed wing of the Brexit movement, because I deal daily with people who genuinely do believe in unicorns, I just don't know. I know what the polling says, and I know how many people get in touch with me to say thank you or to essentially apologise. But anecdote, the plural of anecdote, as we often say on this programme, is not data. So we'll probably... I mean, I can't see how it can continue, but then Donald Trump got elected President of the United States of America, so the willingness of people to vote for their own diminishment, to vote for their own pain, if there is a demagogue in front of them insisting that he'll protect them from non-existent foes and threats, is, well, not to be underestimated. You'll have to wait for my book to get any more conclusions on that, Richie. Expecting a live news conference from Salisbury at 12 noon, where you will know one of the people apparently poisoned by Novichok left in the vicinity by the Russian operatives who sought to murder Sergei Skripal and his daughter has now died. So that's a British citizen killed, the British government believes, by Russian spies on our soil. Just gives you an indication of all the stuff that's going on that we should perhaps be focusing on and being exercised by, but can't because of the Brexit nonsense that still continues. A ludicrous, nation-damaging conceit that was framed at Eton in the 1980s by two egotists who never, ever buried the hatchet of their rivalry in the ensuing 20 or 30 years. So make no mistake about Brexit. Boris Johnson was the reason why it happened. And Boris Johnson sided on the Leave side because he thought it would advance his career. There is no integrity, there is no honesty, no reason. It's an astonishing Twitter account based on things Boris Johnson wrote and said prior to coming out for the Leave campaign, which demonstrate a degree of pro-EU thinking and feeling that I believe was in place even when he was throwing his grenades back from Brussels to make the colonels reading the Daily Telegraph chuckle over breakfast about bent bananas. And then 30 years later, you talk to decent people about why they are so, so persuaded that we've got to leave. And you chip and chip and chip at the questions and you pull away the slogans until you leave them naked talking about bananas. And that is it. People are going to lose their jobs because Boris Johnson persuaded them that the shape, the curvature of their banana was politically significant. And still the charlatans, the shysters, the snake oil salesmen, the spivs and the pantomime toffs, still they persist in insisting that there's something good, that the light of the end of the tunnel is not, as most of us now recognise, the light of an oncoming train. Craig is in Sidcup. Craig, what would you like to say?
Hello, James.
Hello, Craig. Hello, mate.
Good morning. Okay, so you posed the question earlier about Davis, you know, what's he been doing for the last 2 years, digging a hole in his back garden? Okay, my question would be, what's Barnier been doing? He's representing 27 member states, like emerging states, Poland and so on. This is a crucial deal for Europe as much as it is for the UK, so...
He laid out the negotiating strategy, I think, just the back end of 2016, didn't he? And he hasn't shifted since. We only laid ours out on Friday, and the bloke who's been in charge of writing it for the last 2 years resigned on Sunday night. I don't know that the parallel you're drawing is even vaguely pertinent, Craig.
So you also posed the question, there's been 4 hours of negotiation. So is that fact, or is it just...
It's been reported, it hasn't been denied. It's been reported in reputable sources, and I know Barnier has expressed grave dissatisfaction at how little time he's been able to spend with David Davis.
So you'd have us believe that, you know, that not even a text, I think, was one of the comments, so Barnier is just sort of like hanging around in his back garden, digging his hole.
But we've already established that that's a silly... David, we've already established that that's a silly thing to say, Craig. Just saying it again doesn't make it less silly.
You've been making me laugh out loud all morning with a lot of the things you've been saying. So, you know, equally, they are silly things, you know, digging holes. And, I'll pose the question again.
No, but the point about digging the hole was that David Davis has resigned after 2 years in charge of EU negotiations.
Yeah.
So what's he done for the last 2 years? I know what Michel Barnier has done for the last 2 years because they publish every single syllable of it on the EU websites, I mean, which you clearly don't know. So don't sit there nodding going, They publish every single syllable, every codicil, every clause is there and published. Yeah. The negotiating position is utterly clear. Can you tell me what ours is?
And immovable.
No, can you tell me what our negotiating position is?
Is immovable. Well, no, I'll tell you what I think, okay?
No, I want you to tell me what our negotiating position is.
Our negotiating position has been held off.
What is it?
I'm about to tell you.
Oh, good.
I believe that our government has held off. They played the long game. They wanted to disclose what our proposals were at the last minute. So, effectively, getting a deal out of Europe that we wanted, Europe wanted it as much as we do. They've got to. And no one ever answers that question. Does Europe want it as much as we do?
Well, that's because you don't define it, you see. So, again, I understand your confusion, but you can't ask people whether they want something without telling them it is.
But a trade agreement.
Well, what sort of trade agreement? There'll be trade agreements that they don't want, and there'll be trade agreements that they do want, but none of them will be better than the one they've currently got.
So straight away you're saying that there is an interest in both parties to reach an agreement.
There always is with trade agreements, but again, you're not listening to your own words, Craig. You use the word it or the word something or the words trade agreement. Do they want a trade agreement? Well, no. You have to ask what trade agreement you're inviting them to comment on. And that is the job of the people that are seeking to leave, because everybody knows the rules of membership of the European Union.
Yeah.
Everybody knows what a third country is. The United Kingdom is seeking somehow to create a bespoke status that has never before been seen. Now, it's it's not the job of the European Union to describe that bespoke status. It's the job of the European Union to respond to the description of that bespoke status provided by
the
British...
interests of their member states.
No, you must stop talking before you've understood what I'm saying, let alone what you're saying yourself. Good. Okay. So the rules are established, the negotiating strategy is published, every syllable and codicil of what the European Union work from is clear. Mm-hmm. We're seeking to create a bespoke, unprecedented status never before seen in the history of the European Union. We will take it to them, and the negotiations will involve them essentially explaining which rules can accommodate our bespoke status and which rules will inevitably entail them rejecting that element of the bespoke status. The European Union can't do anything with its published, established, formal negotiating strategy until it sees what the United Kingdom is asking for. You voted to leave the European Union. We leave in March of next year. You still don't know what we're asking for. You should be so cross and embarrassed now.
I know you're not.
I can tell your tone.
No, I am. In respect, I am. Okay. And I discussed it with my daughter this morning. And the words came out of my mouth. Second referendum. And I pray that people now realise when they finally do find out what we want as a country to leave, agree on that. And vote on it and say, yeah, we do want to leave. And these are the reasons why.
Well, give me some of the reasons, then. Give me some of the reasons.
Okay, my initial reason, and it's an opinion, okay, so...
Well, that's not a reason.
Bear with me. Well, no, but it's an opinion. That's why I voted.
All right, what's your opinion?
With the emergence of good economies throughout the European member states, you've got a massive migratory workforce that is available to companies like, I don't know... Virgin, so on, people like that, Ashley Sports Direct, that pay them a minimum wage. You know, and I find this, I'm always becoming a socialist when I look at this from the outside.
Well, then you know what the answer is.
It's wrong.
If you're almost becoming a socialist, we need trade unions to negotiate higher wages using collective bargaining and the threat of industrial action.
Yeah, but you do, but that doesn't stop the pressure on a country that can't... It's not a bogus.
Of course, number one, the European Union has already introduced legislation to stop people being hired on less than what the native wage would be. So that Jeremy Corbyn objection to European Union membership has already been shot. But if you want to improve the wages of the workforce, you do not begin by dividing the workforce according to nationality or country of origin. If you want to improve... you're going to have to listen and understand what I've said before you can respond
go ahead,
to it.
Sorry.
You improve the wages of a workforce by treating every member of the workforce the same and insisting that the employers do too. And you threaten to down tools if you don't get pay rises. And then the right-wing media turn around and say, well, there's plenty of other people who'll do the job. And then you realise who's actually gulled you. It's the people saying, well, there's plenty of other people to do the job. There aren't. The jobs are finite, and the jobs grow. Every person who comes here to work is also a customer, Craig.
Yeah.
So economic growth depends upon population growth, and population growth depends upon immigration, and most industries in this country depend upon immigrants.
Yeah.
But you voted to leave the European Union because you think that there's too many of them and they can move too freely.
No, not too many of them. They can move too freely. I think people are being unfairly treated. I think that's the whole agenda of the European Union.
Then you unionise.
Pardon? Yeah, well, union, yeah, absolutely. But, you know, who's going to represent... I mean, how many years is it going to take for unions to get themselves geared up to represent people from European countries that come over here?
When we leave the European Union and we lose the protections,
the
workplace protections that have been established, why do you think these people like Rees-Mogg want to leave? Actually, answer me that. Why do you think Jacob Rees-Mogg wants to leave the European Union?
Because he believes Britain's better... outside of here.
That's a belief. I don't care what he believes. Give me a rational reason for it. Don't use the B word. A rational reason.
Because we will be stronger.
A rational reason. Because I know what it is, and you do as well. You're just embarrassed to say it out loud because you voted for it.
No, not at all. I'm never embarrassed.
Okay, well, what do you think when they talk about a bonfire of the regulations and you talk about workers not having enough protection, explain to me how getting rid of regulations is going to deliver your reason for voting for Brexit, which was to improve the regulation of workplace. How is getting rid of regulations in workplaces going to improve the lot of the workers that you claim to care about?
I think people are being victimised.
No, I know you do. I'm going to ask you the question again. Regulations in the workplace. Brexiters want to get rid of them. How is getting rid of the regulations that are currently in place going to improve the lot of the people that you think are already being exploited? In other words, let me put it really simply. How are you going to improve their position by ensuring that they have even fewer rights than they have now?
Unions. But I already answered that question.
Martin, you didn't. I did, mate.
Mobilise that. And, no, I said that. Yeah, I agree with you. Craig, unions.
So we need more unions, and you shouldn't have voted to leave the European Union.
No, not at all, Craig.
I can tell you what, mate, your daughter must have her work cut out. It's like something out of a Franz Kafka novel, isn't it? You spend 2 years in charge of the United Kingdom's negotiating position with the European Union. Your job title is Secretary of State for Exiting the European Union. At the end of a two-year period, when you have been in charge of that negotiating strategy, ostensibly, arguably... He hasn't been in charge of it because Theresa May realised pretty quickly that he wasn't up to the job, but she left him in post because to sack him would have been too difficult to pull off in the face of her parliamentary weakness and her party weakness. But after 2 years of being in charge of it, the government finally puts together something that they can take to Brussels as a starting point for the substantive parts of the negotiation, the bit where Brussels say, well, this established rule means that you can't have that, but this established rule means that you probably can have that if you just do that. That's how it happens. The minute that it's published, the minute they actually get written down on paper, the strategy that the Secretary of State for leaving the European Union has had 2 years to put together, the Secretary of State for leaving the European Union resigned. And still they cheer. Still the unicornists applaud. The mind truly boggles. Which is why we're not moving on from this subject until probably October. 11:56 is the time. You're listening to James O'Brien on LBC. Bunch of questions still in need of answers. What is it that Jacob Rees-Mogg believes in that Theresa May doesn't? What exactly has David Davis been doing for the last 2 years? And why, in your words, has he resigned? 11:57. Anne's in Boston in Lincolnshire. Anne, what would you like to say?
Hello, James.
Hello, Anne.
What I'd like to say is that when I was preparing to vote in this, I found out that it costs us £350 million a week to belong to the EU and that we would get back some of that. So, in fact, the net cost every week is £250 million we spend out. So all the free trade and everything costs us £250 million. Since then, I can't get past it to be able to believe that it's not good for us to come out. And also that the government wouldn't have given us the vote if it was so catastrophic that we should come out. So that's why when you speak about the things you do now, it goes in one ear and out the other, because nobody's dispelled the £250 million it's costing me every week.
Well, and you've seen how much...
The companies... at the moment, the public pays the £250 million every week, but when we leave, it might cost the companies £10,000, 10%, you know. So that's why I think they don't want us to leave.
No, but the money comes from taxation, which companies are going to be paying on a much bigger scale than individuals like you and me are.
Yeah. So
the other point is...
I can't get past...
Well, no, you keep saying that. I can help you get past it if you want.
Yes, please.
Okay, first question. How much is the divorce bill that they told you we wouldn't have to pay, but they've now admitted we will?
It's now going to be supposedly 40 million, but if...
No, billion.
I don't think we have to pay that, do we?
Billion.
Yeah, but we don't have to pay it if we walk away, do we?
In the sense that you don't have to pay your mortgage if you walk out of your house. You do, actually. I mean, you could refuse to pay it, but you'd not only be breaking the law, you'd also be sending a very, very, very loud message to the people that you're hoping to strike up trade agreements with in the future, which is, well, you can't trust us.
But I just can't get past the £250 million.
Okay, well, let me explain it to you, because nor can Jacob Rees-Mogg. This is what you call the net dividend, or the net cost of being in the European Union. If you look at the amount of trade that we do with the European Union, the largest single market in the world, 500 million customers. Now, the analogy I always use is a car boot sale. Now, it costs you 20 quid a week to get a pitch at the car boot sale, right?
Yep.
You decide that you're not going to do the car boot sale anymore, so you are, de facto, 20 quid a week better off, right?
Yep.
You're saving that 20 quid. Problem is that you make a 200 quid profit every week when you go to the car boot sale. So, in fact, you're 180 quid worse off. So what you've done is focus on the 20 quid we pay for the pitch, and you've completely overlooked all the money that we make from doing the business that we do as a result of having the pitch. Does that help?
It does help, but why would they say it's a net contribution this country makes if they weren't taking it?
Because that's the money that comes back for infrastructure investment and all the other things that are directly spent by the EU, as opposed to the money that we make as a result of having a pitch in the single market. I'd talk to you more if you want, but I have to cross live to the news now, because we may cross live from the news to the press conference in Salisbury. Questions that we are utterly failing to answer on the programme today are: what does Jacob Rees-Mogg believe in that Theresa May does not? What has David Davis done for the last 2 years in return for his $140,000 per annum? And in your own words, why did he resign last night? I thought I'd made my first Brexit boo-boo yesterday. I tweeted at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and I thought it's important to be honest when you sort of got things wrong. I said, I haven't been surprised by anything Brexit-related since about a week before the referendum, as regular listeners to the programme will know. But I honestly can't understand how there hasn't been a cabinet-level resignation over what's happened this weekend. 7 hours later, there it was. So I guess that's a bit of a humble brag. So it makes a change from my usual utterly unhumble brags. Sean is in Liverpool. Sean, what would you like to say?
Hello, James. Really happy to get on to your show.
Don't sound it, Sean.
No. I think the reason why I'm about to say something quite negative... I feel like there's finally came a time now that people, in order to stay on the voting registry, need to take some sort of test so that they actually know what they're voting for. Because I feel like there's a lot of media bias. I'm not going to go into that.
Sure.
But I think people are disillusioned with politics. It's been very negative, probably as far... I'm 32, but in Liverpool, it's as far back as Thatcher and other parts of the country. Then going into Blair's, illegal war, if we can mention that, and things like that. And then austerity since 2010. There's so much negativity with politics these days that I feel like people would actually confuse UK politics with EU membership when it came to voting. For the referendum. I voted Remain. I'm very proud to be from Liverpool, and the fact that 58% of us did Remain.
How much of that do you think has to do with the fact that the Sun doesn't get sold in Liverpool? And I'm not sort of just as an anecdotal aside between you and me. Admittedly, there's a few people listening, but from outside Liverpool, it's not a city I know well. But the fact that the Sun couldn't get its hands on the people who read it in other cities. Do you think that was relevant?
Definitely think it was relevant. Yeah. 100%.
It'd be fascinating, wouldn't it, to conduct some sort of thought experiment. What would have happened if the Daily Mail and the Sun didn't exist? And Liverpool gives you at least an opportunity to find out what happens if the Sun has no oxygen.
Yeah, exactly. So, I mean, we've received over €2 billion in funding for Liverpool. When I was growing up in the 90s, anyone listening for Liverpool here might not agree, but Liverpool was a dump, to be quite honest with you. It needed so much work. It's got the money... admittedly, not all from the EU, but an awful lot of it. And now it's constantly reaching, second or third best place to visit in the UK. And it really is a lovely place to come. One of the reasons why I believe in this vote is because, just to give you an example, the people around my age in Liverpool who didn't vote to Remain, for instance, a lot of them come back to immigration, which I'll just skip over that. Can't be bothered getting into that, if you don't mind.
feel free. I wish I could.
Yeah, a lot of the people are of the older generations who say, this country's going down the pan and et cetera, et cetera. A stat that I always come back to, and I think a caller from Newcastle or somewhere northeast said, every time you have a conversation with someone and you point out some facts, they just throw them back in your face. Yeah. And they just turn the conversation around. Britain joined the EU in 1973, which means that if you were born in 1953, you were 20 at the time and spent pretty much all your working life in an EU Britain.
Yeah.
So if you want to tell me that you've had a great time in the 70s and the 80s and the 90s in work, which older generations constantly do, my uncles and cousins voted to leave because they think it's going down the pan, like I said. You spent your whole time in the European Union. So why can you turn around now and throw it away? It doesn't make any sense at all. And I had to educate myself. Yeah,
but this is where you and I get a bit patronising or condescending or sneering because we think it's really easy to educate yourself. It's also really easy just to comfort yourself with a soothing slogan, mate, a seductive slogan. And I know that that's patronising. Unfortunately, it's also true, and we've seen it on both sides of the Atlantic. Because remember your mood when you came on the programme when you said, "Oh, I'm delighted to be on the programme." I said, "You don't sound it." You know, what's that old figure of speech? You sounded like a man who'd bought a something and got a something. But that's what happens when you work stuff out and think about it. That's why the Remain campaign was always on the back foot, because it was essentially reflecting reality or worst-case scenarios. The Brexit campaign, because it had no relationship with reality, that got to tell people, A, that their country was going down the toilet, and B, that it would have an amazing brand new dawn if they voted to leave the European Union. It was, in retrospect, it's a miracle that the result was so close, because doing what you do doesn't make you happy. Understanding stuff doesn't cheer you up.
definitely. And just to point out another conversation I had on the weekend with an uncle of mine who's 68, something like that. He started talking about Switzerland and Norway and how we can get the same deal as they do, and you know, we can get rid of all these laws. You know, I think people still don't realise that Switzerland and Norway still have to have European laws
and freedom of movement, mate. Not just European laws, I don't get cross with your uncle, because there were fag packet fascists, snake oil salesmen, and demagogues standing up in this country, literally saying during the campaign, "Why can't we be like Norway and Switzerland? They seem to be quite all right." And then literally saying, as soon as the campaign was over, that would be a red line, and if we do anything like that, if we don't get rid of freedom of movement, because they didn't have to tell the truth. They lied to your uncle to get his vote, and now the truth is slowly emerging. Your uncle doesn't want to admit that he was lied to.
Exactly. And as soon as you mention that, it's, "No, you're wrong, you know, you're wrong."
Get over it, you lost.
Exactly.
Will of the people.
But that was all. That's the only point I wanted to make.
And in regards
to David Davis, I think he resigned because he just realised that what the government wants, it can't be done. But I don't think we're ever going to find out.
Well, I know. And well, I mean, in a way, his resignation is an acknowledgement of reality, but it also frees him up to continue pretending that reality doesn't exist. It's a very self-serving move, actually, which makes me amazed Boris Johnson hasn't done the same, because if it's self-serving you're looking for, then Boris Johnson normally leads the line. Liam writes, "You just said something I completely disagree with regarding trusting the government in relation to the Russia poisonings, Iraq, Windrush, Brexit, universal credit. Are you taking calls on this?" Not at the moment, Liam. I'm neck deep in the Brexit stuff. But there isn't an alternative narrative from a foreign power on the things you describe. Windrush, the scandal emerged as a result of British journalism. Brexit, the British government was very honest about how ridiculous it would be until the country actually voted for it. Universal credit, we know the truth about. It's a straight choice between our government explaining why British citizens have fallen foul of a nerve agent on British soil, and the Russian government, who routinely kill dissidents, lock up journalists, criminalise any form of opposition to the government, and there's a straight choice. And you're perfectly entitled to choose Russia, but the point is, the fact that you think that there's a choice to be made is victory for the authoritarians, for the fake news providers, for the Russians in this case. It's just coming out to 12:15. Thanks for that, Sean. I don't know why I should get more calls from Liverpool. 03456060973 is the number that you need. And the questions are still in place, actually, as we await that news conference in Salisbury. I want to know what it is that Jacob Rees-Mogg believes in that Theresa May doesn't. It's astonishing that no one can tell me, isn't it? I mean, genuinely astonishing, especially after Friday, when all the people who normally are a little bit busy or scared to ring in, when we're talking about the Donald Trump balloon, they were queuing up to make fools of themselves live on the radio. But on this one, what, it's not a trick question. What is it that Jacob Rees-Mogg believes in that Theresa May doesn't? Just to use his own words. And I, of course, as you will know if you're kind enough to listen to the programme on a regular basis, I reserve the right to ask you to explain the words that come out of your own mouth. So when you tell me what it is you think he believes in, I might say why, or what does that mean, or how does that work? And that is, of course, the most compelling evidence of sneering, condescending, Ramoning that it's possible to find if you read certain newspapers. Actually asking questions is a sign of the unaccountable elites. You should just swallow whatever crud you're being served up by people like Rees-Mogg, and then you should thank them for the privilege. What do you think David Davis has been doing for the last 2 years? I've asked that question in a slightly cheeky fashion this morning. I shouldn't have done, actually. Or at least now I'm changing the tone of that question. What do you think, Dave? I'm getting angry now rather than quizzical and mischievous. What has he been doing for two? We have paid that man £140,000 a year for 2 years. What has he done? His job was to conduct the negotiation, and the first part of conducting the negotiation is to confirm the negotiating strategy, which didn't happen until Saturday. And then he resigned on Sunday. So what the hell has he been doing for the last 2 years? I'll take anything you've got, whether you're a fully paid-up member of the bovine-chomping Brexit Brigade or whether you are a very unfashionable fan of evidence and knowledge. What is it? What is it he been doing? What has he been doing for the last 2 years? 03456060973. I'm sorry so many of you can't get through. I should probably talk less and rattle through some of the calls, but I do want to know what it is that Jacob Rees-Mogg believes in that Theresa May doesn't, and I want it in a digestible and rational form. So something that is measurable or provable, as opposed to something that is religious or cultish. I have to be careful how I say that. Steve's in Bromley. Steve, what have you got?
Hello, James. Hello, Steve. Thank you for speaking to me. You're is welcome. It right if I have a rant?
You can if you want, a bit of a rant, but there's, you know, well, I suppose, yeah, I have to let you.
I think you get probably closer to the truth than most of the other journalists we have on the radio.
That's
the
very kind. Is there a big butt coming?
Yeah, there is a butt.
Yeah. I like big butts. I can't lie.
The Americanization of Britain cannot proceed any further with us being a member of the EU club. America does not want the European Union to become the United States of Europe, and it doesn't want the euro either.
When you say America, which bit of America do you mean? Because Barack Obama, of course...
I'm not talking about the ordinary American people. They're the same as us, the same as the Russians.
But who are you talking about? Because Barack Obama was pretty adamant that leaving...
I'm talking about the money people of America.
Right.
What we loosely call globalization, American-led capital.
Yes.
As the European Union is at the present time, it is difficult for America to maintain control over Europe. When they were separate countries, the American speculators in currencies, for example, could pick each country off at will, really. I just think that this is...
So we call it the toxic capitalist. Well, I've heard it before.
The tectonic plate's moving here.
Oh, well, I've heard it before, but that's another reason to remain.
I agree.
I thought that butt was going to be bigger.
I voted Remain, and I've always been a fervent European.
So you're left with this question that I struggle with, which is why are these people like Robert Mercer funding outfits like Breitbart, which are dedicated to persuading British people to act against their own interests? And the answer is that because people like you and me don't understand that level of greed, do we?
No, that's right. You're quite correct.
Because if you gave me 10 million quid now, Steve... That's it, mate. I'm hanging up the headphones. I'd only come to work out of love. I would not have 10 million quid in my bank account and go to bed every night thinking, how can I have more? How can I have more? How can I have more?
This is the thing. You've got monetary control over the world now, which we call globalization. Unfortunately, I do think the tables are turning against globalization. I think American foreign policy has earned them a lot of ill will in the world. And there are other big groups like the Chinese, the Indians, the Brazilians, who are forming themselves in very large groups, and we want to be on our own. And what, by the way, in February I happened to find out by mistake on the BBC, Evan Davis's The Bottom Line.
Yes, very good program.
And they had some share experts on, and they were telling us that 52% of the British shares on our stock market are owned by American hedge fund. Another 15% are owned by Asian and Arab money.
Well, that's why the FTSE went up after we left, because the pound went down and all of these people's share values went up.
That's correct. There was also the other thing where we were told about wider share ownership, and pension funds are down to 3%. and our insurance companies are down to 5% of the stock market.
I didn't know that.
Perhaps that's what they mean by... Well,
what's a vassal state, then, in the context of that observation, I wonder, Steve?
Well, if I give you the reference, it's the bottom line, Radio 4, yes. BBC Radio 4.
Careful, my boss is... I'm going to get in trouble now with the boss you're advertising the opposition. They hate it when that happens. I shall dig it out. I shall dig it out. No, I've got no reason to doubt it, Steve. You'll forgive me for cracking on. I'm going to end the programme with a full switchboard still waiting to speak. It's one of those days where everyone wants to talk about the biggest story in town, and it's my job to let them. Thank you, Steve. Yeah, I suspect he's right, but I think ordinary people like us struggle to understand how someone who's already got £1 billion in the bank can wake up every morning desperate to get more money out of the pockets of ordinary people. If you think I'm exaggerating, one word for you: Uber. Well, we have a superstar celebrity guest in the studio. It's a young man you may already be familiar with. I think that LBC played a small but significant part in his rise to political prominence. I speak of Femi Oluwole, who is also the figurehead, although I suspect he'll probably claim that it's a primus inter pares position that properly reflects the essential equanimity of democratic institutions. But our future, our choice, seeks to represent the views of young people as this dread ship, Brexit, lurches ever closer to the icebergs. I invite you in without really having a plan, Femi. I just sort of felt that it was ridiculous that we hadn't met yet.
Yeah,
given our...
it's been too long. I mean, there's been too much back and forth. And...
Well, I didn't think there was much point, because we're both out there fighting the good fight, and this is, you know, we might well be crossing the streams in the studio today,
exactly,
but it's not necessarily going to achieve anything. Where are you then? I know you're at Chequers at the weekend. In terms of general optimism or pessimism, what do you think is currently, especially given David Davis's walking of the plank overnight, what do you think is currently most likely to happen in the context of Brexit?
I think that we have a situation where only 11% of people think Brexit is going well. Now, that was before our chief...
Who the hell are they?
I know. I think that they must be somewhere in the country, but, you know, takes all different sorts. Mm. But if that was the case before our chief Brexit negotiator resigned with only 3 months left of an 18-month negotiation period, I can't imagine what the figures are now. Now, if nobody thinks this is going well, given that the basis of the referendum 2016 was 52% of people thought this would go well, how can the end product be the will of the people?
The problem is, of course, that as David Davis proves, and as Jacob Rees-Mogg proves even more, is that there is still a very powerful rhetoric out there, or a belief-based argument, that it could have gone much, much better. Now, you have educated yourself in European Union law, and you've studied it prestigious institutions. I think it could have gone better, couldn't it? I mean, they could have perhaps waited. They could perhaps have got a negotiating strategy in place before they triggered Article 50. That would have been the logical way of doing things.
Yeah, I think it would have been nice if we'd have actually had a plan. I mean, instead we decided to trigger Article 50 and then have a general election and then have complete chaos, and then with a couple of months to go, still not have figured out what position to go with. So yes, it could have gone a lot smoother. But we were always going to get the red lines that were created by the loud Brexit voices, like saying we can't be in the single market, we can't be in the customs.
But that never happened before the vote. This is where I kind of need to speak to people like you occasionally, instead of just standing in the middle of the pitch, dealing with googlies from all comers. Because no one in the run-up, there's so many times now where you have to pinch yourself or you have to double back and check. 22%, you're even more of a fan of statistics than I am, 22% of Leave voters thought there was a risk of having to leave the single market before they voted for it. And yet, almost within an hour of the result dropping...
It was the idea that we'd leave everything.
It's incredible,
but
isn't it?
It's what happens when you get a campaign that's just fueled by nothingness. You had David Cameron, and Leavers are right when they say that it was Project Fear. He said you need the single market without even once explaining what the single market was, a system of rules that means you only need to make a single version of your product for it to be legal across 28 countries. Mm. That makes your products cheaper. Now, that wasn't even explained during the referendum. So when we have a decision as to whether or not to leave it or to stay it or to have some sort of relationship with it, of course we haven't got any clarity on that.
Did you realise at the time how dismal the Remain campaign was?
Yeah.
You did?
It was what pulled me off the bench back in January 2016. I was watching David Cameron not explain what the single market was, not respond to the concerns regarding immigration. I mean, you had You had Nigel Farage saying that the EU forces us to let migrants come here, live off benefits and clog up the NHS, even though the EU has rules specifically against that, which David Cameron should have been implementing but chose not to, unlike other EU countries. He was never going to say, I hear your concerns about immigration. The reason why they're not being put in place is because I haven't been doing my job. So I was watching just a terrible campaign.
When you hear Farage say things like that, and I know you've spoken to him a few times, not as often as you'd like, do you think he's lying, or do you think he just doesn't understand things?
That's difficult, because...
Is it?
Yeah, I mean, I want to believe that he thinks he's doing the right thing, but when you say things that... I mean, he point-blank said the EU allows completely unrestricted immigration beforehand, and now he's saying that, yes, we chose not to use the EU's rules afterwards. And did he learn what the EU did after 40 years, after 18 years of working with it, just in those last few months? I struggle to believe that. When he had his Breaking Point poster, when he pointed at all the refugees that the EU was forcing on us...
Morning that Joe Cox was murdered, of course.
Yeah, exactly. And when he pointed at that, even though the UK is not part of the common asylum policy, which means it's the UK's decision to let refugees in or not, which is a completely different debate as to whether or not we should, but he made us think we didn't have a choice. So... whether or not he was intentionally lying, I don't want to speak to that, but the fact is, he led us down a garden path.
And it was a garden path we never would have reached the end of without the interventions of Boris Johnson, because you needed some ostensibly, or at least outwardly respectable politicians who'd managed to get elected into the House of Commons to add a patina of plausibility and credibility. Who's your kind of number one villain? Who do you think actually has behaved in the way that is most at odds with what you know to be factually true from your studies?
I'd lean towards...
You're such a nice man. You don't like these lines of questioning, do you? Well, tough, you're in the wrong place.
I don't like calling people liars. I like to believe that they meant to do the right thing.
I was like that once.
But, I mean, you've got Boris Johnson with his lie about giving $350 million to an NHS. When in fact, we rely on EU immigration to keep the nurses and doctors that our NHS desperately needs. You've got people like Daniel Hannan, who said, absolutely nobody is talking about threatening our place in the single market. Yeah. And whereas he's produced a Brexit that is taking us out of the single market. You've got Nigel Farage lying about immigration when, in fact, it's keeping us alive. You've got David Cameron, who failed to give us the basic facts about Brexit. And you've got Theresa May, whose plans are to repeal the Human Rights Act afterwards. It goes directly against everything that young people need. We need stuff to be cheap. We need progressive values. That's why I created Our Future, Our Choice, because that's the only way that young people can make themselves heard. Because everyone needs to join Our Future, Our Choice and make our voices heard, because this is not going the way that is going to help us at all.
Dean's been in touch to say the sooner this lad is in charge, the better. Ask him when he's standing. Do you have political ambitions?
I think I have to stay in politics for a while. I mean, I got what politically motivated me at the start was I was working. I mean, I've always wanted to work in human rights. I wanted to make sure that
because you studied law.
Yeah, course, studied
including
law,
including EU law.
Yeah,
how many prominent Brexiters have studied EU law?
Well, David Davis says that, what did he say? What's the requirements of my job? I don't have to be that clever. I don't have to know that much. So David Davis, I don't think he knows a lot of things.
Surely you're exaggerating. I don't think he ever actually said that out loud.
I think he said it on LBC.
Well, what's the requirement of my job? I mean, I don't have to be very clever. I don't have to know that much. I do just have to be calm.
Oh, yeah. Oh, my God, you were right. Unbelievable. He said exactly that on LBC. Listen, we're going to run out of time. You've mentioned Our Future, Our Choice. How do people find out more about it?
You need to go to OFOCBrexit at Facebook.
I'm very uncomfortable with that acronym for you. One of my 46 years. I appreciate you're pronouncing it correctly, but if you take the first letters of the four words, Our Future, Our Choice, you will end up with the acronym that you need.
Yeah, exactly. I don't know what's so uncomfortable about it. It's just the Our Future, Our Choice.
I know it is. And
then Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and the website is OFOC.co.uk.
I'll tweet from my account after the programme as well.
But so. it's important to join if you, because the Brexit can be stopped, but it needs people to actually realise that this is not what we signed up for in 2016, and we have to have a vote on the final deal. A people's vote on Brexit is the only way to actually make sure this goes the right way.
Two more questions. One, are you more or less optimistic today than you were in July 2016 that it can be stopped, that it will be stopped?
Well,
more or less. No, simple one-word answer.
I'm more optimistic.
Okay.
There.
And the second thing, speculate if you would on what the prize is now for the Rees-Moggs of this world. What is it that they are still dreaming of, do you think?
They hope that the deal gets so bad the government gets forced into a no-deal situation.
And why do they want that?
Because they have fundamentalists in their beliefs that the EU is bad, that we need to be completely separate from everything to do with cooperating with our neighbours, and they want a no-deal situation. And a no-deal would be a betrayal of 1.3 million British citizens living on the other side of the Channel, because it would force them to have to apply to national authorities just to live in their own homes. That's what David Rees-Mogg is promising. Every time he says that no-deal is better than a bad deal, he's literally saying, screw 1.3 million British people.
Femi Oluwole, many thanks indeed for your time and for your sterling efforts in the pursuit of truth and evidence-based politics. I admire your youth.
I appreciate that.
I remember before my carapace of cynicism and disappointment overtook me, I could sound a bit like you. It's 12:47. It's one of those days. I don't know where it's gone. I feel like I've only just sat down. Possibly a sense of fatigue added to by the energy of my studio guest, Femi, who, if you follow me on Twitter, at Mr. James OB, I've just retweeted a tweet from the Our Future, Our Choice account, which seeks to represent the interests of young people, something that you thought politicians were supposed to do, but I'm not quite sure whose interests the Brextremists represent now, except fellow unicornists. It is, I think, impossible to make a reasonable case. You probably could have done before Article 50 was triggered, or before people started pretending that Norway and Switzerland hadn't been offered up to leave voters as an example of what we could reasonably attain after leaving the European Union. As soon as they started pretending that leaving the customs union and the single market had always been written in stone, as soon as that happened, everything went nuts, didn't it? And the extent of the nuttiness is highlighted by the fact that the man who's had 2 years to come up with our negotiating position resigned within 24 hours of it being published. Hello. So, three questions. What is it that Jacob Rees-Mogg believes in? What is it that David Davis has been doing for the last 2 years? And what is it that you think best explains David Davis's decision to resign? 12:51 is the time. Julian is in Devizes. Julian, what would you like to say?
Yeah, good afternoon, James.
Hello, mate.
I've been scratching my head trying to think of what Jacob Rees-Mogg actually believes, and I've come up with an analogy which I disagree with you in slightly about religious belief.
Come on.
But I think is actually to do with extreme religious belief and just the same with extreme Brexit belief. Now, if you have extreme religious belief, for example, there are people every year at Easter time in the Philippines who offer themselves up for crucifixion.
Yes.
Because they believe this is the case.
They're only temporary crucifixion.
Yeah. And I mean, they're taking down after.
But martyrdom, of course, would be a better example of people who are genuinely prepared to sacrifice their lives because they think it's what God wants. It's not by any means confined to Christianity.
No, absolutely. The jihadis and so on and so forth. So my point basically is that I think Jacob Rees-Mogg, just like some extreme religious people, doesn't actually really know what he believes.
Well, they do, because they're going to go, I'm going to go to heaven. or I'm going to get 20 virgins or whatever. So even in a case of extremist, fundamentalist religious fervour, you can at least fill in some of the gaps of what it is that's at the end of the proverbial rainbow. What's at the end of his rainbow?
Well, it's better for him, obviously. I mean, that goes without saying. So therefore, you could say the same with the jihadis and the martyrs who commit suicide.
How is it better for him?
Well, clearly he thinks he's going to make more money doing something else, and also that.
I see. I'm a cynic, more cynical than most, I think. But maybe I'm not actually. Maybe I'm more naive than most. Maybe I'm both. Anyway, you're not my therapist. I don't think he is financially motivated on this. I do, because if he's financially motivated, the religion analogy falls apart completely, doesn't it? He's motivated by a belief in something that you and me can't articulate or understand.
Well, yeah, exactly. I mean, I think the problem, though, is that, you know, like extreme beliefs in anything, they have to be motivated by something.
But it's not money. I don't think it's money.
But maybe he just believes in his own hyperbole. I don't know.
He believes in some sort of weird Commando magazine version of Britain or some 19th century image of, I don't know. I mean, it's as close as we're going to get, isn't it? It's trying to work out what heaven looks like. I don't know. Whatever. Everyone's got a... there you go. He's right, isn't he? Everyone's got a different idea of heaven. For me, heaven would involve a PlayStation, my family. It probably wouldn't involve your idea of heaven, wouldn't involve my family. That'd just be weird. So everyone's got a different idea of heaven, you know? Slush puppies. I'm fond of slush puppies. I might have a slush puppy later. Stephen's in at Castel Jaloux. I think the third or fourth time you've appeared on the programme, Stephen. Today you speak for France.
It's the third time, I think, James.
I know.
Anyway, what would you do with 20 virgins, for heaven's sake?
That's probably just apologies.
Anyway, about David Davis and why has he resigned?
Yes.
I don't believe for a minute that it's spontaneous. I actually think we're going to see more resignations, and I think it was part of what they were discussing on Friday. I think Boris Johnson will probably resign, Esther McVeigh possibly. Liam Fox, he doesn't do anything anyway.
Well, why did they not all go in one go?
Well, because then they all get their moment in the spotlight.
Yeah, you could be right. I wonder what Theo thinks about that. And so then it is bring down the government, replace Theresa May with a unicorn.
I don't think Michael Gove will resign because he's been recasting himself, hasn't he? You know, he's the puppy-loving environmentalist who's shown over the weekend how loyal he is so the Conservatives can get behind him. Now, you know, I know you're going to think I'm a bit of a cynic, or maybe this is a conspiracy theory, but the next day or two are going to see whether I'm right or not.
Yeah, I know. I'm not going to tell anyone they're wrong these days. Anything could make. We are living in a country where a bloke who's had 2 years to come up with a negotiating strategy resigned within 24 hours of it being published. And nothing. And also that phone line is frightening me slightly, especially watching the news coming out of Amesbury. It is 12:55. Stephen, many thanks. He's gone for the hat trick and he's scored again. Richard's in Brixton. Richard, what's going on?
Hi. This is all about democracy, and that's the point of democracy is so that you can get an idea of what's actually happening on the ground. So basically, people put in their votes and tell you, you know, what's going on in their households. And a lot of people gave the message that their households are distressed, and this EU thing is not working for them.
That's what they might have believed, but if you'd asked them to explain, as I've been doing for the best part of 10 years, exactly how the EU has impacted upon their lives, they would, to a man and a woman, be unable to.
No, I don't think they care about that. That might be of importance, but I think what's more important is that, you know, you don't go down the same path when things are not working and keep going down that path. When you think things are not working, you say, look, I've got to try something different. And these guys... actually trying something different. I mean, you had Cameron go in there and try and organize something different. It didn't work. These guys, at least Morgan, those characters or the Leaf people, are saying, look, we want to try something different because this is distressing our home.
What do they want to try?
Being out of... leaving.
Yes, but what does that involve? What does that entail? What will the people who are, you know, have got deliveries waiting at Dover do the morning after we leave?
Yeah, I mean, even that is not so important. The point is that their house is burning down.
No, it is to them. It's really important to them.
They don't want to keep doing the same thing that will burn it down some more.
Yes, but their house isn't burning down, is it? They've got a house, and you're suggesting they voted to abandon it.
The point I'm making, I know there are a lot of people living in luxury who want to remain, but I'm just saying that, look, there are a lot of people out there facing very serious challenges.
Just talking more loudly doesn't make you more right or indeed less wrong. They then need to explain how leaving their house or burning it down is going to improve their lives. And before they do that, they need to explain how membership of the European Union is responsible for the paucity of their experience. Otherwise, you're going back to faith-based politics.
But that's exactly what I'm trying to say, which you don't seem to get it, you know, get the point of. And
I'm sure it's my fault.
They know one thing. They know for sure is that where they are is hell. They're sure of that, and I hope you can understand this because this is real lives and people in real homes.
Yes, the one thing you don't understand is that even if they are in hell, the question of how they got there is one that needs to be answered before they can work out how they're going to get out. And unfortunately, snake oil salesmen, spivs, pantomime toffs and sundry other demagogues have spent the best part of 40 years telling them that they are in what you describe as hell as a result of European Union membership. Everybody now knows that's not true. The only people pretending it still is are those who have so much ego and invested in the con that they will never, ever be able to acknowledge or admit to its success.
Have a great afternoon, Richard. How you doing, Mr. Top?